It's raining, it's pouring, the old man is snoring. Welcome to a very wet pre-show on Juma Private Game Reserve. Of course, my name is Brent Leosmith. I have Desmond on camera today, and we're under the roof with all the rain covers on. Now, the one thing I'm slightly excited for, actually I'm more than slightly excited for, is the fact that we might get to see some frogs this morning. And of course, there's also, you might notice, lots of termite alates around, so we could get some good birds of prey as well. And other birds, for that matter. This is, believe it or not, great birding weather. And that is because the termites have emerged. Big cat weather? Nyeh. Well, unless we bump into them, it's almost impossible to see tracks in this weather. So we're just going to have to bumble around. Hopefully we'll stumble into one. But other than that, we're probably going to be looking at lots of birds and small things on this wet sunrise safari. Now, as I said, the thing I'm most excited for is frogs. Now, the place to find frogs is where the termites are emerging from the ground. So I'm looking for a good emergence zone. And I'm hoping to see my favorite grumpy old man today, the bushveld rain frog, as I get attacked by alates. And of course, termite alates are attracted to light. And we are pretty much like Crystal Palace with our side lights and big front lights on and presenter light on. So we can expect a lot of termite attacks during the course of this morning. Now, there we go, they're on the ground here. Now let's have a look for some frogs. Yeah, froggy, 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 froggy. I saw one at the DRC, an African bullfrog. I haven't seen another one since I got out. Now, of course, frogs are not the only things that are going to be taking advantage of the termite emergence, and I have found something that is. Okay, I'm just, so with the rain covers, it's quite difficult. There we go, to the right. In the middle of the light. There we go. Turner's thick-toed gecko, by the looks of things. Oh, there we go. There's a nice big gecko. Was it a... No, it's a little spiny lizard. Well, that's a massive, it's not a little one, it's a massive one. I thought it was a gecko, but now looking closely in the light, it's one of the little spiny lizards. Now, he's probably been flushed out of his hole by the rain, and combined with the termites, he's going to be ecstatic. Lots of things to eat. Now, there's always a good chance we're going to see some snakes in this weather. The rain will often push snakes out of their holes, and also a lot of snakes are great termite eaters. So, let's see what we can find. Now, in weather like this, you've got to be extra careful as you drive along, that you don't drive over some poor critter. Wow, that is amazing. I'm going to try and give you a front-on visual of that lizard. Where'd he go? Oh, he's still there. Desmond, can you get him? Over my shoulder. No, you can't. Let me keep going, going. There. I think. There he is. Isn't that cool?
This program features live coverage of an African safari. and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning, good morning. I'm in a tent, and this is Safari Live.
Ready.
Standing by.
That was a very rushed good morning to you, so let me say it very calmly and collectedly. Good morning. My name is James Henry. David is on camera, and we are in the safari tent this morning. We're in the safari tent because outside, moisture is falling from a very thick blanket of cloud that has covered the low veld, and it is giving that great blessing, of course, of Africa, rain. Out there in the field, who is feeling slightly less than blessed, Brent Leo Smith, and Jamie is trying to fit a roof to Jigger so that she too might join him in soaking herself. And I must just say at this juncture that last night, just before we all went to bed, I said to Brent, would you like to walk in the morning? And he said, oh no, and he sort of touched his left hip like this. Don't think I can walk tomorrow morning. So I said, no problem, I'll walk. And then as the rain started to fall down this morning, of course, suddenly he decided that it would have been a good idea for him to walk, because the walker comes to the tent, you see. So I said, and now he, of course, is very wet, and David and I are dry and comfortable here in the tent. Now, we are going to require your help for the length of time that it keeps raining. Well, we always require your help, but especially during a drive like this, when, of course, we're in the tent, we need to have a conversation. It's always good to have a chat to you, but let's try and generate some good chat while we're in here. Obviously, there's less to see in the tent than there is outside of it, but in the rain, the cameras do struggle. So hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. You can ask us anything you like about Africa, about South Africa, about the wilderness, about any creatures. Let's talk about the natural world. And we'll have some good conversations here from the tent and try and join them up with whatever is being seen in the field by Brent Leo Smith, who is looking a little bit like a drowned rat at this stage. Good. Now, the first thing I found this morning was the smell of snake when we came in here. This is not a snake. This is, in fact, a piece of rope. It's used for decoration from time to time. We're not entirely sure why it's in here, but it is quite useful from time to time, like I say. And the smell of snake is very distinctive, and I'll just show you what was smelling. It was a piece of skin found the other day, and it is a black mamba skin. Now, I mean, were you ever to see a black mamba this size, or any kind of black mamba, you would be deeply afraid, and you would be deeply afraid with good reason. Look at it. Isn't it terrifying? Oh, oh. Yes. That would be able to inject enough venom to kill you with almost just a look. Anyway, this black mamba skin smells like snake, unsurprisingly. And snake smells, especially when it's wet like this, like a... I don't know if you've ever been around a huge sink full of washing. And a huge sink full of washing that has not been washed properly and has that kind of eggy smell to it, that's what this smells like. And I walked in here and I thought, ooh, gosh. There must be a snake in here. Looked under the desks and eventually we found the skin. Thankfully, it wasn't the original owner of the skin. All right, Brent Leo Smith has managed to sufficiently cajole himself into a state where he would like to bid you a fond and very wet good morning.
Hello, hello. Welcome to a wet Juma Private Game Reserve. Isn't the rain glorious? My name is Brent Leo Smith and we have our interviewee Desmond on camera. Now, because it is wet and rainy, I'm looking for some of my favorite things. Frogs being number one on that list. And maybe as it gets a bit lighter with all the termite alates around, we might get some fantastic views of some of the Aquila eagles and other birds munching on the high-protein snack that is a future termite king or queen. Oh, we've got spiders inside our tent. So we have our own very own mobile tent at the moment. So we've got a roof on, we've got our rain covers on. And if the rain stays like this, it's good news. We should be able to keep moving. If it gets too hard, we'll just drop the sides and close ourselves in. Remember, this is a live safari, albeit a damp one. And you can ask us questions by using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter or email us a question at questions@wildearth.tv. Now, of course, my singing voice is terrible, but I think we should convince James to burst into song and sing us Singing in the Rain. I think he might fight us on this, but I think if we get enough tweets in, so if you want James to sing Singing in the Rain, send it through to hashtag SafariLive. Beg him, goad him, poke him, get him to sing Singing in the Rain. Of course, out of all of us out here, he is going to remain the most dry. Morning, Kathy. Kathy would like to know, are flying termites male or female, and do they bite like soldier termites? Well, they can bite, but it's not nearly as painful as the bite of a soldier. And the reason for that being is their mouth parts aren't that developed. Now, they are both male and female. It is the future kings and queens, or queens and drones, to be exact, of the termite race. Now, I've actually seen 3 or 4 different species of termite alates out this morning. And the biggest one we've seen is probably from the northern harvester termite, and that is the favorite food of a lot of the Aquila eagles, particularly the lesser spotted and steppe eagles, although all the big birds of prey, even the massive martial eagle with a wingspan of nearly 7 feet, will eat termites. That's how rich they are in protein. There's this spider webs. Now we are going to go. It's rained more than the other night, but not that much yet. But if this rain sticks around and this weather sticks around, a good soaking of the earth is what is needed. So sometimes rain like this is much better than a large storm that dumps quickly and moves on. This rain dumps slowly over a period of time, and it enables the water, the ground, to actually soak it up. It doesn't just run off towards the little river systems. Okay. Now we are checking around the treehouse waterhole area, and fingers crossed. I don't think we're going to see any tracks today, so we have to rely on bumping a big cat in this weather. So let's hope our bumping luck is on fire. So while we continue our search for amphibians, mammals, reptiles, and of course the many insects around, let's go say a very good morning to a slightly damp Jamie Patterson.
And a very good morning to all of you, and welcome to our very damp sunrise safari. My name is Jamie, and this morning I have a very damp Brian on camera with me. Brian, how's the thumb? Is the thumb... The thumb stayed at home! The thumb got to stay in bed because of the rain. Oh, lucky thumb. We're happy to be out and about. We are very damp and covered in flying ant wings. That's pretty much been our start to the morning. They appear to be sort of damply fused to every part of the vehicle. I had 3 in my coffee this morning, 3 flying ants, which is not my record. But it is an interesting way to start. A flying ant, of course, is an alate, a reproductive member of a termite colony, and they erupt after the rain. Brent always talks about the eruption. Well, we are definitely experiencing the eruption of termites, which is wonderful because it means we could see snakes, we could see frogs, we could see, well, we could see birds. They're going to be a little bit bedraggled, but basically we're going to be doing a wonderful rain drive and I'm quite excited. There we go. Once Upon a Time says that they would really like to see frogs. I would also really... out of my eye, Flying Ant. My coffee's fine, my eye is not. I would really like to see frogs as well. I haven't seen that many this year. And most of them, in fact, all of them have not been whilst we're on our safari. So I'm quite looking forward to frogs. I'm looking forward to snakes. Looking forward to all sorts of things. Feeling slightly dripped on, Roof. You and I need to have a little discussion in a moment about... there. Okie dokie. Let's go and see what we can find. I'm also going very, very, very slowly. We are driving Wendy this morning, which is one of our vehicles. We have three. I'll just cover that over as well, since it is mission critical. We have three vehicles, and one of them, Wendy, isn't really meant to be serviceable, so hopefully she survives. Oh, it sounds as though Mr. Hendry is up early and he might have found the very thing we've been looking for.
I'm not entirely sure what I found here, but I think, given its size, that it's a pygmy toad, except having looked at the picture of the pygmy toad, I'm not sure that that's true. Now, what we're going to do is have a look at it under the microscope. Just simply, I mean, that's a pretty good view you've got there. But let's have a look under the microscope. Because he really is quite cool. Oh, hang on. hang on. It's a little difficult to do. There we go. How cool is he? Now, the reason I actually don't think he's a toad is because he's got that very flat face. Oh, sorry, the microscope is really playing up a little bit now. There we are. So I think that flat face tells me that he isn't perhaps a toad. He might be a frog of some sort. So any ideas what frog this is? Hashtags for our live questions at wildearth.tv. Look at his colours. What I'll do is quickly move the microscope round onto the top of his face. Oh, he's he's climbed into it now. No, you can't go in there. There we are. Let's just put it on top of his body here. Come on, man. It's so deeply frustrating because you can't... it doesn't move the same way you think it's going to. Hang on a sec. There we go. It'll work. There we are. There's his skin. That's the top of his skin. And I think you'll find that a pygmy toad's more warty than this. But I'm not a great genius when it comes to amphibians. And I find that every time we come to summertime, I've forgotten half of what I used to know by the time the rain ended. Anyway, so we'll find out what this little frog is during the course of the drive. And he too is waiting to eat the termite alates that are around. I was trying to find one of those to show you under the microscope when I caught this fellow. Anyway, I'm going to keep him with me for a little while and hopefully he'll be able to be released fairly soon once he's identified and we can set him out to find the much smaller species of alates. So I think that's probably what he's going to be going for. Now, I believe that many of you were wondering about snakes out here, and I will tell you that we found a snake in the box where we plug in everything this morning. I was sort of fossicking about in there, trying to find where all the wires go early this morning, and there was a snake in the back. Tiny little brown thing, I think probably a brown house snake, hopefully. Definitely wasn't a cobra, and that's the thing you've got to worry about. Sheila, you're wondering in London, of course, about that black mamba skin and what happened or how long it took that enormous snake to get out of his skin. I don't know how long it takes, Sheila. I think it probably varies per snake. It probably varies on the age of the snake. But that That skin's about 3 meters long, which is about 9 or 10 feet. And so I think you'll probably find it took him, once they've hooked it into the branches, I don't think it would take much longer than, say, an hour or two. And it's crucial, of course, that it doesn't take longer than that, because then they are very vulnerable. And even a black mamba is vulnerable, especially to birds that might want to try and bite it and eat it. So I think they have to get rid of the skin pretty quickly, otherwise they would become too vulnerable. And they often do it out in the open. You know, they hook it into a thorn. They sort of rub the... They rub the nose off first. They'll find a hard surface and sort of break the skin around the nose area, and then it starts to come off the head, and then they'll hook it into a thorn and sort of wriggle out from there. And they can't afford to do that. It was impossible to do it inside a hole or somewhere that isn't exposed, because obviously there aren't thorns other than in exposed areas. So I think they have to do it pretty quickly. I wouldn't say that it took that mamba much longer than an hour to get out of its skin before it slithered off and found something else to eat. Marvellous. Brent Leo Smith is carrying on the amphibian theme for the day. Let's go and find out what he has.
I've found one of my favorite froggies. Yay! I'm just trying to set up my spotlight. So, wait, let's try this one. How's that, Desmond? Is he in the light? Oh, I think this is actually a she. But look at that grotesque belly. It is so full of flying ants. I don't think she can move. Okay, I'm gonna jump out and have a quick look. Now, this is one of my favorites, as I said. It's a bush felt rain frog. But this one is ridiculously fat, and it is a lady rain frog. The males, this one does have it, normally have a very mottled chest, and they do look like grumpy old men. I'm just like, let's turn. I know you're very fat from all the termites, but you need to turn to show everyone how grumpy you look this morning. Now, you should be happy, not grumpy. How's that? Let me come have a look at the monitor. That is literally the fattest bushveld rain frog I've ever seen. Look at that. Now, they do definitely look like grumpy old men. This is a grumpy old lady, though. It is so fat. It's ridiculous. Now, the reason I say it's a female, it's quite big. The males are a little bit smaller. And also, they generally have a much darker throat. Now, with frogs, that's not always the case. So here, I'm probably just going off size that it is a female. Now, they have a very interesting life cycle in comparison to most frogs. And the thing is, so they do not have any webbing in between their toes, so they're not great swimmers. They are great diggers. So also, with that very strange body shape and those very short legs, very fat body, it's very difficult for them to mate successfully. So the female will actually secrete a substance that causes the male to stick to her back. Once she has finished mating, she will dig backwards into a burrow and lay up to about 45, quite big eggs for a small frog, inside the burrow. And of course they are covered in they actually develop far more than normal tadpoles inside the egg, and the female will actually stay close to that nest and guard them till they come out as little froglets on their own to go have a look at what else. Now, I'm really hoping that we can add more frogs to our frog list. I've now discovered on my new frog app there is a way to just ding, and I add it to the list. So this is my first frog of the year on the list, and hopefully we're going to add some more. I really hope we find a Mozambican rain frog. Very similar, except it looks like a fat little strawberry. It's like pink and orange, but we never know. I have seen them in the Sabi Sands before, never in this area, but it is always possible. So there we go. Two amphibians already this morning. We did predict some amphibians to be out and about. Hello. Hello, Bethany. Bethany would like to know whether we have tree frogs in South Africa. Yes, indeedy, Bethany. We've got quite a few different types. The most common tree frog we get in our area is called the grey tree frog or the foam nest frog. We actually have two that live in our room and help keep the mosquito populations under control. One lives in on Jamie's jacket where it hangs in the cupboard. Now, they are also the ones that make those big white nests that we find around waterholes. Oh dear, there's that bushwalk alarm. I'm not on bushwalk today. I should maybe take that off. Okay. Now, we're going to keep looking for frogs. Good morning, Michael. Michael would like to know whether there are any poisonous frogs in South Africa. Now, toads are also frogs, and quite a lot of the toad species are poisonous, especially toads of the family Bufo. So I think James had a toad, and I don't know if he showed you those raised things behind a toad's eye. Those are called Bufo glands, and they secrete a noxious substance when the frog is disturbed. Now, if you've ever had a dog or a cat that attacks certain toad or frog species, they start frothing at the mouth. That's the Bufo toxins. It's generally not fatal, but it's generally enough to create such an unpleasant taste that they are able to escape. Now, the other noxious frog that we get here has got one of my favorite frog calls. It's also a very pretty frog. It's called a banded rubber frog. And the call goes, I'm going to play you the call and I'm going to do my imitation of the call, and let's see, you can decide which is how far off I am. So the banded rubber frog goes like this. And that, oh wow, raining on me, stop it. They're a very, very pretty frog, and let's just have a quick look here. Froggy frogs. Okay. Rain frogs. No, we want rubber frogs. Leaf folding frogs. There's lots of different types of frogs. Snoring frogs, snoring puddle frogs. Where are the rubber frogs? Why are they so far down this list? Because I've probably gone straight past them. Ah, there we go. Banded rubber frog. So let me show you a picture of them first. Isn't that cool? So, like very noxious frog species like you find in South America, you do get that aposomatic colouring, red and black, warning creatures that it is not nice to eat. Okay, let's put the volume on and let's... Oh, why are you not playing the song of the frog? Come on, let's play the song. Okay, you ready? Let's see. It doesn't sound anything like I just did. I think my pitch was a bit off. I needed to be a bit higher. It is a very, very cool call. And I'm hoping, generally we need a bit more rain and the little pans to become a little bit more full before we start hearing the rubber frogs constantly. But we're going to continue our search for everything amphibian. And while we do that, let's go see how Jamie is doing.
I might not have found a frog just yet, but I have found our first somewhat bedraggled large mammal of the morning in the form of this herd of kudu being photobombed by flying ants everywhere. And yes, all of the animals out here are actually quite skittish, which always happens in this sort of weather. They'll start to relax again as it gets a little bit lighter. Luckily it's not windy, so whilst for them last night was dark, rainy, and probably very scary, this morning's not too bad. And it's not too bad having a little bit of rain. It means you don't have to go for your morning drink. You can just eat the leaves and get the dew at the same time, or the rain, the moisture off the leaves. Hello, girlie. They are still a little bit skittish, so I'm going to let them move slowly before we reposition. Definitely looking somewhat damp, and unfortunately for all of the animals out here, When weather like this hits, they don't have any roofs, they don't have any way of sheltering, they just have to lump it. A lot of them do move into dense vegetation. So often we find on drives like this, it's quite quiet, but it is also perfect, perfect big cat weather. They're often far more active and mobile. Just gently with Wendy. She doesn't want to do much moving. Hello, ladies. All watching us with those. Yes, have a good shake. In the settling rain. And actually, for many of our animals, this rain will actually be a true, well, obviously, not just because it's going to be a truly positive force, not just because it's going to make the grass grow and the trees green, but it is also because many of them, and I'm sure you must have noticed with not just the lions, not just with the Styx pride and the Nkuhumas, but with Impala, Nyala, a lot of the animals out here after the drought have come away with some sort of mange infection. Or infestation is probably a better word. And the rain is the one thing that helps to heal them. It just washes away the mites. It makes it harder for them to survive. And as a result, most of the animals out here will recover from it. But there are definitely a few very patchy-looking impala. Kudu less so, but there's definitely been a few bald antelope, or almost bald antelope. I wonder if they know. I think it must feel good for those of them that have that itchy skin affliction. I can hear the frogs, Brian. Loud and clear. Predominantly olive toad. Croaking away. Now we just have to find one. I want to see a bushveld rain frog. There is one right here somewhere that is so loud. In New Zealand, you want to know if there are any animals that specialize in catching frogs. None that I would say specialize in it, just because, of course, frogs are so seasonal, but there are quite a few that capitalize on them. So snakes are a big one. Frogs, very often when you have frogs, there are snakes in the vicinity. Snakes are very big eaters of frogs, and then little animals like genets and civets will occasionally snap up the odd frog. And of course, I know that Brent was telling you about the banded rubber frog. That is one frog that doesn't have to be too concerned about the actions of predators. And then every now and again, some of the smaller bird species will also go for frogs as well. And by that I mean smaller raptor species, not your lilac-breasted rollers or your drongos. I mean things like little goshawks might also snatch up a frog or two. Legavans, or rock monitors, serious hunters of frogs. And terrapins, of course, will also prey on frogs' eggs. And tadpoles, if they can catch them. And what's going to be frantically happening now, which is why these frogs are croaking away. Oh, crocodiles. Sorry, Aaron. That's actually one animal that really does specialize. Baby crocodiles. We tend to think of crocodiles as these massive creatures that love to catch wildebeest, passing wildebeest, and Thompson's gazelle, as we saw with James in the Mara. But actually, considering how long it takes a crocodile to reach its full size, there are a lot of hatchlings swimming around that are this big that will prey off something like a crocodile. And the reason why, just straight after the rain, you get this chorus of frog calls is because they know the puddles are coming. And what they want to do is breed as quickly as possible, lay their eggs in a puddle, in a temporary puddle, and they do that on purpose. It's not because they're stupid and they've made a mistake and the water source is going to dry up and their tadpoles won't make it. It's because there's a far less chance of crocodiles inhabiting temporary puddles, which means that their offspring have a better chance of surviving. So that's why there is this frantic chorus of frogs as soon as it starts to rain. They're all desperately seeking company. And Connor, you say, can we expect to see a lot of the frogs' predators today? I'm hoping so. I suspect, though, our a lot of our sightings are going to be flying ant-based rather than frog-based. Now, the clever things about frogs is that they have a ventriloquist effect to the way in which they call, which is why I didn't jump out and go immediately searching for that frog that was calling next to us, because I know it could actually take me... It could take me quite a while. It could take me a long time. They are able to throw their voices, so it's much harder to pin them down. And most of their predators, of course, are either aquatic or they are nocturnal. I'm not sure whether Kirsty wants to see the view that is just around the corner, just to give you an idea of how the rain has set in. It is just around this corner. Let's check. We're not going to miss a leopard just because we're thinking it's quiet out here. Just to give you guys an idea of what is on its way, this is good rain. This is proper summer rain. This is what we should have had last year and we never did. And we're all overjoyed. Okay, let's go to one of my favorite view sites. This is one of the best views on Juma. One of the best places to see what's going on. And the answer to what's going on is it's quite rainy. I didn't quite bank on that angle of that roof, but nevertheless, you can have a roof and some dribbles. My apologies. The best view on Juma, including the roof. Sorry about that. I had sort of hoped I would dodge it. Well, with that idea well and truly flummoxed, let's go over to James and have a look at what he's got in the tent.
I still haven't identified my little frog, everyone. Anyway, I'm going to give you one last look at him, and then you can try and tell me what you think he is. The thing to note here is that he's got a very flat face, a little bit like that rain frog that Brent had. And so I'm now going through the list of the rain frogs to find if there is one that is so small. This one is only about 15 millimeters long, so about half an inch. So he's very, very small indeed. Anyway, we will identify him and then release him to eat. Well, not this particular one, because this one is too big. But there is a termite, a flying termite. This one, I'm afraid, has ceased to fly. That is not my fault. It lay on the ground, and its ability to fly is now completely over. And it will hopefully, when I release it into the ground, find a mate and start to make new termites. Now, I always love this time of the year because, for me, this is the culmination of millions and millions of individuals' efforts. They try so desperately to produce these young alates, and like a sort of royal coming out, if you like, they emerge from the ground to great fanfare from the rest of the mound. Now, I'm just trying to see if I can get this thing in focus. Unfortunately, I'm failing miserably, which means I'm probably going to throw something in a temper fairly short. There we go. Oh, I know that. Oh, dear. Sorry about that. He really is not playing ball. Sorry about that. I think it's got the microscope and use David's skills rather. Now, he's about to shed his wings, so if he loses them while I'm holding them, I'm not too worried about it. He will still be released into the ground where he will release his pheromones. There we go. There is the termite. Royal. Now, what they do, if this is a female or a male, and I don't know which it is, and in fact, I can't bear to watch this thing moving around like this anymore, let's release him and put him out. What they do is they flap their wings, if they're a female, and they exude a pheromone. And that pheromone travels up into the air and into the nasal passages of one of the males. And hopefully the male comes from a different mound from which the females come, so that there might be some genetic mixing, if you like. And then they mate, they go down onto the ground and shed their wings, and together they dig a little honeymoon tunnel. And they go down into the tunnel, whereupon the male and the female will start to dig a little chamber. And almost immediately the female will start to grow from something that big to eventually something that is that big. That is the size of her abdomen when she's finished growing. And from her abdomen will come roughly 15,000 eggs every day. and that is how the termite mound begins. She will make workers to start with and soldiers, and eventually she will make the new eggs that will become those alates. Now, obviously, there are far fewer termite mounds than there are the number of alates out here, which tells you that many, 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 many of them, in fact, probably 95% of them get eaten by the predators out here. So you can see what a massively important part of the ecology these termites are, especially for animals like you're about to see with Brent Leo Smith.
Well, there we go. I said we're going to find some of the bigger eagles on the ground. Isn't that cool? That a wet looking eagle, that one, but they are absolutely loving this weather, as you can see, feasting upon all the termites. Now, especially when they're a bit damp, these true eagles can be a little difficult to see or to identify. I want you to let me know which of the eagles you think this is. I was hoping he's going to pop out into the open again. Oh, he's there, but there he is. Hoppity hoppity hop. Can see the termite alates. So if you know which eagle this is, send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or #SafariLive on Twitter. Now, what you want to do is look carefully at the gape, how far the mouth extends to the eye. You want to look at the color of the eye itself and the bill, and also at the legs. Those are your main IDing features with the large brown eagles. As you can see, they don't look like they're designed. They're definitely designed to be more in flight than on the ground. They do look a little bit awkward as they prance around. Oh, he's got a wing stuck on his beak. Now, at this time of the year, if you get really big emergencies, you can get massive flocks of these birds. Now, let's keep... Wait, just go back to the eagle there. Just wait till he comes out into the open. Now, David has guessed a steppe eagle. And, David, I'm going to say... probably not a steppe eagle. Now, the reason for that is what when he pops out into the... Oh, off he goes. Where's he going? Oh, he's off. Now, David, from a steppe eagle point of view, remember the gape of a steppe eagle extends a very long way. So the gape extends beyond the eye or behind the eye. The gape of that eagle, to me, was very far, or quite far forward, and the legs looked not as baggy as a steppe eagle legs. So I'm going to let everyone else have a guess, but it's not a steppe eagle. And we're going to continue on this beautiful wet morning. Now, remember I told you to look at the legs, and James, you said a snake eagle. A snake eagle does not have feathers on its legs. It's got bare legs, so it immediately rules out all the snake eagles. It's definitely an Aquila, a true eagle. All of them have feathers all the way down their legs. Now, which one is it? We've ruled out steppe. There's a couple of others still to rule out. Now, A lot of different types of eagles have different color morphs. That was a dark morph. A pale morph is very, 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 very light. Safari Dean was wondering. So out of the eagles we get here that have pale morphs, Warburgs, tawny, booted, and very, very rarely in step or lesser spotted. But that was a dark morph. So dark chocolate brown, not sort of a pale color. Oh, something walked there, but I can't see what under the rain. Oh, it seems like the because it's a little bit wet, it's confused a lot of people, and it wasn't a lesser spotted eagle. This, I mean, they were very, very, very skinny feathers on the legs, and they've also got a very pale eye, and that had a dark eye. Desmond, what did you think it was?
It looked like an eagle.
It was an eagle, according to Desmond. Yes, Desmond, you're 50% correct. It wasn't a crowned eagle either. Crowned eagles are very, very rare in this area. And generally, if you are going to find them, they're going to be around major river systems, which we don't have any of here. They're more of a forest or riverine species, the African crowned eagle. Wow, guys, booted eagle? I'm afraid not. I think just because it's a little bit damp, it's catching everyone. It's the smallest of the true eagles, or I suppose booted's also about the same size though, that we get here. Oh, hello, guys. Lady, Lone Wolf, and Anastasia say, oh, they're off on the move. A tawny eagle. No, that is one of the bigger eagles we get here. Oh. There we go, all the little tails up. There's a little boy. Morning, Kuduth. I'm just running for the joy of the morning. They're looking quite happy and relaxed. Okay, off they move. I think a lot of you out there are going to kick yourselves when I tell you which eagle that was. Now, hopefully, we have a little bit of big cat luck. Well done, Paul and Mary. It was indeed a slightly bedraggled, wet Warburg's eagle. A dark morph of the Warburg's eagle. Well done, Paul and Mary. I think everyone got so used to me asking the difficult questions that we overlooked the obvious. What have we got here? Oh, buffalo, but before the rain. Hippo before the rain. So just make out the underlining track, almost impossible to see. And just making out the general shape, there's no defined lines. Now, we're slowly moving down Cheetah Cutline at the moment, hoping to find whatever might be out there. While we do that, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
I'm glad to hear that Brent's birds of prey will sit still long enough for you to be quizzed on them, because so far Brian and myself have seen three, and all of them have flown away the minute I tried to reposition to get a view of them through the front of the vehicle. Now, I don't quite know what it is about me, but they... Oh, my word. Termites everywhere. I don't quite know what it is about me, but they just don't want to sit still. But I've seen one Warburgs, but also one what looked like a juvenile goshawk, which would have been really nice had we managed to get it on camera, but it actually flew away before I even had a proper chance to look at it. And so we are proceeding slowly but surely towards Treehouse Dam. Not really looking for anything in particular. Of course, we're always hoping to bump into the Queen of Juma, the female leopard Karula, while we are in this area. But actually, we don't have anywhere in particular to go. We're just looking for various things that have come out after the rain. And so far, the dominant species is, of course, termites. What a lovely question from Diane. There's a good idea for a place to go. Diane, you were wondering about what the ibis family, the hardy-dar ibis family, might be doing in this weather, and whether or not Mom will keep the chicks under her wings. Yes, probably she will. She'll probably shelter them, she'll probably sit over them, and keep them as dry as possible. I'm not quite sure exactly what stage of development they're at, but they probably haven't got, in fact, they definitely won't have fully waterproof feathers yet. And chicks are, like all baby animals, they are very sensitive to sudden changes in temperature. So the last thing they need to do is get soaked to the skin and then have cold air sort of blowing over them. So yes, Mummy will be keeping them as sheltered as possible. I'm just trying to work out the logistics of how we could manage to get that nest on camera with this roof. I'm not sure. I don't think we're going to manage it, are we, Brian? We could try, definitely. I was thinking about the Wahlbergs as well. Well, I have to say that Mr. and Mrs. Wahlberg haven't been very present in that nest of theirs at all. I haven't seen them sitting there often. I don't know whether they've moved nest sites or if they've been unsuccessful. But yes, having a look at birds' nests is definitely a nice way to spend the morning. Brian and myself were just talking about, well, wondering, whether or not birds actually enjoy this weather. Probably not the driving rain part, but if they enjoy, they must enjoy the after effects with all of the insects and things to eat. Oh, itsy bitsy terrapin. Oh dear, hold on. Hold on a moment. While I try and reposition for this itsy bitsy terrapin. Oh, it's going. It's highly mobile. I can't see where Brian can see. Oh, it's gone. It's gone. There we go. Hello, little terrapin. That's why we are driving through puddles very, very slowly. Your head is too big for your body, little terrapin. You've got some growing to do. It's a tiny little terrapin. It's only about the size of my palm. Tiny, tiny. And hide. You can't see me. Oh, no, off again. Stumbling over the obstacles in its path. That's a very young terrapin. And that's why it's always absolutely critical when we're in weather like this to drive through puddles very slowly. And as long as you drive through them slowly, the terrapins will be absolutely fine. They surf, and you never find squashed terrapins in puddles unless people are really driving too fast. But I've never seen a squashed terrapin in a puddle. Where did you go? It's sort of in that gap. This is a bit tricky. It's somewhere there. There it is. Right in the middle of your screen there. At the back. It's very important to drive through the puddle slowly to just give terrapins a chance to surf in your wake, essentially. And the amazing thing about it, and that's why you've got to be careful, is even if it has just rained, if it has just started raining, if the puddles have just started to form, there's a good chance there will already be a terrapin in them. Because they spend a lot of the time estivating underneath the surface of the ground. Oh, those little feet. Half-webbed, half-clawed feet. A fascinating in-between, between a tortoise and a turtle. Oh, back into the vegetation. And Angelina, you want to know if they are soft-shelled. No, they're not. They are hard-shelled. All of our chelonians that we have in South Africa, which range from the tortoises, the leopard tortoises, the The Speke's Hinge Tortoise, sorry, I'm distracted, I heard an ammo falcon. The Speke's Hinge Tortoise, our marsh terrapin, our serrated hinge terrapins, and then of course the turtles that occur on our coastline. They're all hard-shelled chelonians. It was surprisingly difficult to say. But yes, all of them have hard shells. The difference, of course, for those of you that perhaps linguistically call all of these things a turtle, a tortoise is land-based. Where's this bird now? I can still hear it. Tortoises are land-based with feet. Turtles are water-based with flippers and only come onto the surface when they are laying their eggs on beaches. And terrapins are kind of somewhere in between, mostly water-based. Brian, I don't know if you can see this bird from the roof. Yes, you will be able to. It is in the large tree on the right. I think this is... No, that's Cape Turtle Dove. Drat. That is not what we are looking for. Sorry, not that a Cape Turtle Dove isn't lovely, but it's not what I was looking for at all. Oh. It was in that tree! Aww. It was in the tree, it just flew away. It looked like a little falcon. Now, in the rain, Tracy, you wanted to know if perhaps birds worry about their feathers getting saturated and will it affect flying? Tracy, no, they don't worry too much. They are actually not completely waterproof, but largely waterproof as a result of a type of oil that they are constantly spreading over their feathers. They spread their preen oil across their feathers with their bill, and that's why they groom each and every single day. And that will actually serve to waterproof the feathers. Sorry, hold on a moment. I cannot... Lots of conversation happening in my ear. Apologies. It was far too loud. Oh, there's a tree. Found a tree. Sorry, Brian. So no, the preen oil will keep them waterproof. Interestingly enough, there is one animal, one bird, that does not spread preen oil and in any way waterproof its feathers because... It goes underwater because the preen oil actually makes a bird quite buoyant, and that is the African darter. And I don't have any books with me because I had no desire to have them get soaked. So the African darter is a bird that you find around water. It fishes, it dives underneath the surface of the water, and that is one of the birds that doesn't have feathers covered with preen oil. And what it does is it will allow its feathers to become waterlogged. And then after that, obviously, it can't fly initially. So what it needs to do is go and sit in the sun. And you often, when you come to dams, you find darters all sitting on branches like this with their wings out drying because they actually have to physically dry themselves off before they can fly. So that's very unusual in the bird world. And, of course, the ultimate swimmers being penguins, which... We won't see here on our live drive unless we have one very lost penguin, but we will not be seeing penguins here. Oh, those of you with kids will know that on mornings like this morning when your kids can't go out and play, you have to come up with alternative solutions to keep them thoroughly entertained, and I believe that James is planning an arts and crafts session.
Behold, everybody, an aeroplane made from a map. I think this is a rather fine aeroplane. And as Jamie says, it is, of course, raining, and so one must occupy oneself if one cannot go out into the field. Now, I have been looking around, scouring the landscape for things, but it started raining again, so I came back inside, and I made a very fine aeroplane. And, of course, this is made from a map, and when you're a child, and those of you who are parents, pay heed to what I'm going to say to you now, because you will remember it from when you were little. No piece of paper is ever hard enough or big enough to make the kind of aeroplane that you want to make. This, in all my 40 years, is the best possible piece of paper I've ever found for making an aeroplane, simply because it is hard and it is large. Now, when it dries, I will try and fly this aeroplane. It's still slightly saggy, I suppose, but I'm going to call this the Concorde. All right, the Concorde is going to go over here. Here we are. Very fine aeroplane that, isn't it? Now, I didn't just decide to do that. Let's have a look here at the map. And I'm not going to draw on this map because we have to save it for our TV show. But I'm just going to show you what's going on. Right. As you all know, many of you will know, we traverse three reserves. Juma, there. Arethusa, there. And Cheetah Plains there. Now, this is quite cleverly drawn to make you think that they're all kind of contiguous next to each other. Cheetah Plains is actually quite a long way off to the east, and it's a bit smaller than the other two, but it's just kind of the idea of where we are traversing. Brent Leo Smith is currently lurking around in the middle of the reserve, somewhere around there. And he's looking for the lions. Oh, sorry, he's the one at Biffles Hook Dam. So he's actually around Cheetah Plains over there. And I think Jamie was around the Hardy Dar's Nest, which is the twin dams down there. So that's where they are. On this extent, we are over here, just next to the, or in between the camps, if you like. Very pleasant, of course, under our tent. We're not getting wet at all. David, in fact, has taken off his rain jacket on account of the fact that he is not in the slightest bit wet or cold anymore. Mm-hmm. This is a good thing. Oh, and what I did try and do while you were away from here, I tried to catch the snake that we found inside the technical box. Unfortunately, the snake managed to get into a nook that I was unable to retrieve it from. So I will continue trying to get it, and hopefully by the end of the show, we will have the snake for you. I'm modifying my identification of it slightly. I think it may well have been a red-lipped herald. Mildly venomous, not very big, quite cold today, so it won't hopefully attack me. But fear not, everybody. I will fearlessly try and capture the snake for your edification and entertainment during the course of the morning. Anyway, that is the state of play as it is. Now, normally, what happens is that you expect the day to sort of dry out a bit by this time. It has a little bit, but it is still sort of dripping rain. So we are not going to be going out on a bushwalk anytime soon. Up on the top of that tree there, David, I believe there is a dove. Can you see it?
Yes.
And that is the only piece of wildlife other than the termites and the frog that we've seen that I have managed to identify from the tent this morning. And I also think to tell you that the frog that we were looking at, I believe, was a rain frog. I actually think it was a baby bushveld rain frog. And what's interesting about what Brent told you there, remember he said that they come out as froglets. They don't make tadpoles. So they're very unusual frogs. Now, normally, if you find a small frog that looks like an adult, of course, you assume it is an adult. Because if it wasn't an adult, it would have a little tail. And if it was even more juvenile, it would be a tadpole. Well, they're bushveld rain frog, of course. They are not like that. They come out as little froglets. They look like the adult form. And so when you find a tiny little thing like that, about half an inch long, with a pug face like that one had, I'm going to go with little bushveld rain frog froglet. And Julia, you guessed that as well. You agree with me that it was a junior bushveld rain frog. So that's marvelous. Good. I'm glad we're in agreement. How marvelous. Let's go back into the tent. James, you're wondering which frog species takes the longest to metamorphosize from a tadpole to adult. I'm going to say probably the biggest one. I don't know, to be honest, but I think probably the biggest one, so I'm going to go with probably the bullfrogs. They probably take the longest. I mean, they start off as tadpoles that size and eventually end up as frogs about that size, which, ooh, I mean, that's almost sort of 8 inches in length. So I probably the African bullfrog. And in fact, something is coming up. It's reminding me in the really kind of back of my mind here. that the African bullfrog takes an inordinately long time. I'll do some research next time you go into the field, and I'll find out for you. And then, Chai Connie, you're wondering where the frogs hide when it's not raining, when it's hot. Normally under the ground, sometimes in puddles, sometimes on trees. So the foam nest frog, which many of you will have seen before, or you certainly have seen their nests, is a grey frog. And again, I mean, I can try and find you a picture of the foam nest frog. It's a greyish frog. And it's also called the grey tree frog because of that. And there is one very famous one here that lives in Jamie's bathroom, for example, Jamie and Brent's bathroom. That's where it lives. And there was one living here not too long ago as well. So that's quite nice. And then you will find them, where else would you find them? I mean, we are under the ground, in trees, and in puddles. And then, of course, when the puddles go away, when you have no more puddles, then the frogs either go into aestivation, which means that they will have to find a tree hole or a hole in the ground or Jamie's bathroom. And then they will, and some of them will only last a season, I suppose. They won't sort of survive beyond one season. There is the foam nest frog, and that's the most obvious one that we see when it isn't wet. They like to live in sort of nooks and crannies and bathrooms and that sort of thing. Very nice. Oh, Jen, you're wondering if there are any bright-coloured frogs. Well, they're brightish. The ornate frog is an obvious example. I feel bad looking at my phone while I'm talking to you, but I assure you I'm not checking messages or social media. I'm trying to find you interesting frogs. The banded rubber frog that Brent spoke about is also quite... I'll show you him. There he is. He's quite bright. That's him coming out of a hole, a tree hole. That's the banded rubber frog. He's quite bright. But the ornate frog is a beautiful thing, if I can find him. And the painted reed frog is the most obviously bright-coloured one. They are just gorgeous. Look at that. They'll be all over the place and make a beautiful call. In fact, I'll play it for you. Sing, sing. Very nice. They do that all night long. And then I just want to try and find you the ornate frog, which I'm failing. Mind warp while I keep trying to find the ornate frog. You want to know if we get leopard frogs out here? No, we don't get leopard frogs. I don't know what a leopard frog is, to be honest. Sounds quite interesting. Look, if I type in search, leopard frog, no, but we do get the leopard toad. Now, I don't know if that's what you were perhaps talking about. The eastern leopard toad is very common in these parts. There he is. And he makes a very obvious call as well. That's the eastern leopard toad. Is that what you meant, mind warp, perhaps? But we don't get a leopard frog here, no. Right, that is enough of the frogs. Except, this is a very good question from Sylvia, who's wondering about red and black frogs and how they learn not to eat them. Let's go away from the frogs, Sylvia, and quickly go to the monarch butterfly. Now, the monarch butterfly is also orange and black, and throughout the animal kingdom, that coloration of orange and black and yellow and sometimes a bit of white is indicative of poison, toxin, and it's a warning to predators called aposomatic coloration, as Brent mentioned earlier on. Now, what happens with the monarch is that as soon as a bird ingests it, it vomits it up again. It spits it up because those, I think they're cardioglycosides that have been absorbed by the monarch's larva, immediately affect the bird. It can taste that they're not right and it vomits them up. Now, whether or not the butterfly survives that experience, probably about a 50-50 chance of it surviving, is not really relevant to the species, of course, because the rest of them can survive. And so it's still an advantage to the individual to be poisonous because it's probably got a 50% chance of surviving being eaten. And once they've all become poisonous, of course, then birds will avoid them. Now, I suspect with the banded rubber frog, it's a fairly similar thing. I know somebody whose dog caught one of those banded rubber frogs and spat it out immediately and then started foaming at the mouth and didn't show any really bad effects after that. So I don't think they're toxic enough to cause death. Well, I mean, I suppose if you swallow the whole thing, maybe. But I think they taste so bad, they probably create a sensation in the mouth that is so appalling that animals just spit them out. So I think it is largely a sort of trial and error thing, but I do think that throughout the animal kingdom, that red and black coloration makes a huge difference. Animals kind of understand it from genetic memory, I suppose, that they should avoid colors that like that. But largely, of course, if it was to kill the animal, so for example, if you ingested a banded rubber frog and it killed the predator straight away, no one would ever learn that they shouldn't eat that. It would be unlikely. It's much more effective for them to be slightly toxic so that spit it out quickly and then know not to eat that. And I think that's probably how it works. Does that make sense? I hope it does. Let's have another look outside and see if we can't find something else out here. Ah, no. Jeffrey in Texas, you're wondering about salamanders and whether we get them here. Jeffrey, while I look and see if I can't find you something of great interest here on the ground, you want to know if we get salamanders here and what kind we get. We don't get them here. And I don't know, Jeffrey, that salamanders aren't only found in... I'm going to say, I mean, I know you get them in Britain, for example, and newts and that sort of thing, but I don't know that you get them in Africa at all. So I'm not sure why that would be, but I don't think we get salamanders in this part of the world at all. So we definitely don't get any here. Oh, come on, there must be a flower here. I found one earlier. Here we go. Don't know what it is, but I'll come and show it to you anyway. And I'll hopefully go and retrieve one or two more things for the next time when I see you. There is a flower. And it's one of these nondescript flowers. And what I think is interesting about these nondescript flowers is that although they have no colour and almost no scent at all, they clearly have some way of attracting pollinators. I'm going to smell this one, but I don't think it's going to smell at all. No, it's not going to smell at all. So I'm not sure what pollinates this thing, but it's something that finds it attractive. I will throw that away. Oh, Cindy, yes, we do. Yes, we do. You want to know if we get ferns out here? Cindy, we do. And where you find them is normally growing at the base, often of a silver cluster leaf tree. And they are not... They're not the kind of ferns, there's one species that we get here. They're not the kind of ferns that look particularly fern-like. You know, they're not in great, sort of those great, what do you call them? It's not called a leaf, it's called a frond. There we go. Is it called a frond? It might be called a frond. They're not sort of those long things. You don't find them in mossy areas. You find them out in the open like this. And I found one on walk the other day, and we had a little chat about it. And it was under a silver cluster leaf tree. And I think that they grow, David, keep me posted on my audio. I think that they grow off the leaves, at least the roots, of the silver cluster leaf tree. I will do my very best, Cindy, to find you the fern. And if I don't, I will most certainly find you a picture of it during the course of the next segment or so. Right, while I'm searching around here, Jamie has an update for you. I'm not sure if anyone's managed to find anything in the way of cat tracks, but Jamie will tell you now.
No sign of any cat tracks, I'm afraid, although it would take a seriously deep step, I think, to leave a footprint at the moment. There is, however, one Birmingham boy in Biffle's Hook, which unfortunately is to the north of our boundary, so we can't go and have a look at him. I enjoy watching lions in the rain. There's always something quite atmospheric about the whole scene. Their manes and they're just, it's very, very pretty. We're still continuing our search for the Queen Karula. I'm pretty sure this is the beginning of my superhero origin story, because my fingers have got so pruny that I'm pretty sure that by the end of the drive, I'm going to be able to climb up vertical planes, like a gecko. Me gecko girl. No, not prune girl, Kirsty. Gecko girl. Gecko girl has a much better has a much better ring to it than prune girl. Prune girl, keeping you regular. No, 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 no. We'll go with gecko girl. Just climb up window panes in the same way geckos do. I know how he loves geckos. They're one of her favourite things to look at. And speaking of favourite things to look at, yesterday we had the most incredible sighting of a baboon spider. And I have to tell you that that baboon spider has the best name. I went and spoke to Steph about it, and then we looked it up afterwards. It is called a starburst baboon spider. How cool is that for a name? A starburst baboon spider. And Steph says it's only the third time in his life he's encountered or presumably heard somebody encounter one of these baboon spiders. It's the South African equivalent of a tarantula. I was going to show you a screenshot so that for those of you that missed the bushwalk yesterday, you would know what it looked like. I was going to show you a screenshot, but unfortunately I left my devices at home on the base that they might get soaking. So I don't have it with me, but maybe some of you who were watching yesterday could share the screenshots of that particular spider. And there we go. Lacey was asking about our spiders and whether or not there are any that are more active in this sort of weather. I actually think most of them will be trying to hide away and shelter a little bit, because obviously raindrops, all I can think of when I think of rain and insects is it a bug's life? Yes, it is. It's a bug's life where the rain starts to fall, and it's basically, for them, disastrous. They all have to go running and scurrying for cover. I got out of the vehicle a little bit earlier, and I did see some spiders scurrying about, and I did see a daytime solifuge. And I suppose it's worth the risk of the rain, because it's not too heavy, to go and see if they can't gather up some termites, because there's lots of different species of termites coming out. A lot of them are quite tiny, much like that giant land snail that I just drove past. Hold on. Okay, I'm trying to figure out the logistics of this again. Make sure I'm not about to reverse into an oncoming car with the roof.
Hi. We are busy with probably one of the most difficult endeavors in the bush after rain, but we're doing quite well so far. I've been tracking, I'm presuming, one of the Birmingham boys. And a lot of it's guesswork. And you can see where I've drawn that line in the sand there. So, despite what a lot of people think, that after rain is easy to track, it's not at all. It's actually much harder. Now, what happens is the rain compacts the soil, so it makes it very, very difficult. But there we go. These are quite fresh, so I'm saying in the last hour or so, and you can just make out the toes here. There's the front foot, back foot on top. Maybe we'll find some lions. But it is a very slow process tracking in the rain. And I mean, this is the, I can see another track up there, and then they just disappear because he goes onto some hard ground. But we've got a good idea, a general direction. So we are going to continue on. From what I can see, he hasn't crossed down towards Hyena Road yet. Okay. It is quite fun to have a challenge though. And tracking lions in the rain is always a challenge. One lion is even more challenging. Easier to track a pride, of course. Tax. So Taxon's helping me. Tax, the last track I've got is still heading west, but from Hyena Road on the firebreak, and then I can't find anything to the west of that.
but there's no sign of him going down Hyena Road. So I'm going to keep checking the firebreak towards Gari Katlan. Okay, so Tax is just over there. So he's going to check the main boundary. We're going to look carefully here on the firebreak. I keep half expecting him to see him napping under a bush around here. Okay, I'm going to put my concentration hat on and try find us a lion. While we do that, let's go back to Commander Bond in the tent.
Right, I found you hang on, I've just torn it in half. Wait one second. Can you hear me, David? Okay, you can hear me. You may not be able to see me, everybody, but I am doing my best to find you interesting things. Oh, I found something else here. Hang on. David can't join me here, of course, because he will become wet, and that is no good at all. But I have found a fungus, which I'm going to bring to you. And I have also found a number of gossamer wings, like the wings of fairies, which you shall look at under the microscope. See how fearlessly I'm sacrificing my dryness, David, for the cause. I'm so fearless. Here I am. Hello. Right. We have a great collection of rain-bespattered things. What I don't want to do is have to show you these gossamer wings that I found in amongst my now very soiled fingernails. Okay. How can we put this over here? Sorry, David. I do apologize for moving around like this and making your job so very hard. Ah. There we go. Have a look at that. There is the venation on a very small termite's wing. So the one I showed you earlier, which tried to escape very enthusiastically, was, well, probably four or five times the size of that. This is a very tiny one. And like most insects, the wing is kept taut by the hydraulic pressure in those sort of veins, I guess, through which Hemolymph gets pumped. Hemolymph, of course, is an insect version of blood. And that is what we talk about when we talk about gossamer wings. Isn't that nice? There's the leading edge and then the back edge. Cool. Right, so that is a termite's wing. And just the one thing you can see there, of course, is that it was torn off by the termite itself. So you can see the flesh there. I'm just going to see if I can focus in on that a bit better. You can see the kind of termite flesh there, where it was attached to the termite skin. That looks quite painful. But there were thousands and thousands of these where I found them, and they were just underneath the log under which I found the next little artifact. And it's not artifact. Now, Judy H. keeps pointing this out to me. What we have in here are not artifacts at all. Artifacts are of deep historical value and nature. Perhaps samples is a better term. Look at this. Isn't that cool? Now these mushrooms are growing out, oh my goodness, they're growing out of the top of a piece of rotting wood. And they are the same, it's the same rotting wood that the termite colony that, from which that wing emerged is living. So they're living in there. Most of those termites didn't get very far from home, unfortunately. That's quite cool. But we have something else just sort of sitting here. It's quite a, I don't think it's a termite. I don't know what it is. Oh, hang on. Let me do this. It's much better when I put it on my lap and then you don't all get seasick while we try and look here. Mm-hmm. There it is. That is a termite. I think that probably was, at one stage of its life, a flying termite. And I think it's lost its wings, and now it's trying to find a friend. In fact, you can see exactly where the wings were. Can you see that? Mm. You can see the four little places where its four wings attached. And I suspect this is a female termite, and I suspect that because the abdomen is so long and it would eventually have sort of expanded. I will release her, of course, but it would have eventually expanded into that great big abdomen that produces so many eggs every day. Isn't that cool? Now, Leopold, you're wondering about the relationship between termites and ants, and as you've correctly surmised, it's not a good relationship. They are not related at all. They do share and compete for resources in some cases. But remember, all termites are herbivorous. They don't eat meat, and many ants are not. Some ants are herbivorous, like the leafcutter ants, for example, but many, of course, are meat-eating, and many of them like to eat termites. In fact, some of the greatest killers of termites in the world are ants. We witnessed, Brian and I, the most tremendous battle going on the other day, where we dislodged a branch, and in it there was a battle going on where some drop-tailed ants were carrying off tiny little worker termites and probably the termite larvae and going down into their own nest and putting them there, where no doubt they were in for a fairly rough time of it. I think they were going to be eaten by the drop-tailed ants. It seems that ants are by and large the aggressors and far more successful at when there is a battle, but it doesn't seem to affect the termite numbers greatly, or who knows how many, what percentage of them are devoured by ants. Termites apparently still make up more per hectare in animal biomass than any other animal. So just think about that. There are more tons of termite per hectare of land than there are any other kind of herbivorous animal. So you can combine the elephants, you can combine the combined weight of all the impala out here, all the buffalo. The termite mass is greater than all of that. So, I mean, although the ants do eat them and cop them a horrible beating every so often, it doesn't seem to make a huge difference. Right, that's a very good question. Thank you, Leopold. Then, I'm just going to quickly put this under the microscope and try and get a nice picture of it while I answer the question from Frank and Alice, who apparently, I just want to look at those water droplets on the silver cluster leaf. Frank and Alice, you're wondering if snakes eat termites. Yes, certain species of snakes will absolutely eat termites. I'm trying to think of one now off the top of my head. I think you'll probably find that things like brown house snakes would probably eat termites. I think you'll find that all the little snakes, the especially things, perhaps like a striped-bellied sand snake, for example, would probably eat a termite or two. Most things, you know, that even though they might not necessarily eat termites by choice all the time, most things out here, from all the birds, so a good example would be something like a crested barbet, which is known as a frugivore. It eats fruit. They will definitely eat termites when they're out here right now. And many of those eagles, the Wahlberg's eagle that you saw this morning eating termites, is not by default a termite eater. They'll eat reptiles and small mammals normally, but when termites are around, they'll be eaten. And I think you'll find for many of the reptiles, that is the same thing. Now let's just look here. Oh, look how beautiful at that. And Heidi, you were hoping to see some water drops. There is a beautiful water drop on the hairs of the silver cluster leaf. You can see, of course, why it's called a silver cluster leaf. Isn't that beautiful? Sometimes it's not about all the death and destruction that goes on out here, David. Sometimes it's about all these little beautiful things. The world or land of the fairies, where it's all so small. I don't know why I'm talking like that. Please excuse me. I just think it's beautiful. Isn't that stunning? It really does take you into another world, the microscopic world. You can imagine a little ant. Imagine you are the size of an ant walking amongst the water droplets there. And through those hairs, it must be like walking on silk, I imagine. Very peaceful. Good. Okay, we'll put that back. and we shall probably go on another hunting expedition to see what else we can find. I can tell you that the rain does seem to be stopping. Now, Tracy, Dayton and Mary, many of you are asking how animals are able to avoid coloured frogs and aposomatically coloured animals if they are colourblind. Tracy, remember that colourblindness it's relative, so not all animals, it's a spectrum. You're not completely colourblind and then you switch a switch and you become able to see colour. And also, it's the contrast. I think that's what they're probably looking for. So, for example, a colorblind human being cannot differentiate between purple and green. And if you want to find out if you're colorblind, just Google colorblind test, and you'll come up with those tests where they draw numbers in purple in a green background in little bubbles. And if you're colorblind, you can't see the number there. And if you're not, then you can. But that's purple and green. Now, black and orange is clearly sufficiently far apart for the contrast to be such that even an animal that doesn't see in glorious technicolor like us is able to recognize. Birds, remember, do see in color. So the classic example of the lilac-breasted roller trying to eat the monarch butterfly is a really good one. There's no doubt that the lilac-breasted roller can see the orange and the black. Many animals cannot see that, for example. So a genet, I imagine, is fairly colorblind, and they would certainly eat frogs. Would they avoid a banded rubber frog? Definitely. They can probably hear it, and I guarantee you that they can see a different contrast between those bands, the orange bands, which reflect a lot of light, and the black of the frog, which would obviously absorb all light completely. And if you're walking around at night in the moonlight and you happen to be a genet, I think you'd pick that up quite clearly. Right, Jamie is still knocking about the place. I have no idea where she is. I have no idea what she's going to look at, but she's going to tell you now.
I'm on Weaver's Nest. Oh, darn. I am on Weaver's Nest Road, looking at one very bedraggled golden black-headed oriole. Thank you, Brian. That was cheap as that was touch and go there for a second. And it was making the most peculiar golden oriole. What is wrong with me? Black-headed oriole call, which made me think it was a golden oriole. It is not, though. It is a black-headed oriole, and there is a termite. It's made its way into my shirt. Sorry, hold on. Cold hands. I think it's out. I'll find out shortly when it starts to wriggle. So far, it has been very quiet out here. Brian and myself went for a ride earlier, didn't we, Brian? We did. We hit a patch of mud. And unfortunately, when you're in a patch of mud like that, you can't really stop. You just sort of have to ride it out. And we did, and we were fine. You just don't really want to decrease power and slow down. You just want to keep your power constant. So we had a little, I don't know what it was, what you would call it, little ride. And we're back on track once again. And desperately seeking all mammal life. Good morning to Ellen in Arkansas, since we are largely looking at birds and other such creatures this morning. You want to know how local birds are affected by migratory birds that come in. So local birds that live here year-round and those darn immigrants that keep stealing their jobs. Very good point, Ellen. The only real effect that they will have on the birds out here, the local birds, will be the increased competition for food. That's the only thing that I can really think of. For the most part, they don't seem to compete. Oh, no. There's one very important thing that happens. There is a massive increase in brood parasitism because, of course, our Deirdre's cuckoos, although Deirdre's cuckoos are local, but they do return and you hear them far more frequently at this time of year. It's breeding season. And you get the return of the cuckoos, all of the migratory cuckoo species. So you inevitably have an increase of brood parasites looking for a potential host. And with each cuckoo species, they are species specific. So a specific type of cuckoo, let's take for example a great spotted cuckoo, it is not going to go and parasitize a woodland kingfisher. It will go and specifically target fork-tailed drongos and starlings. Those are the species that it will, and some of them have, like the Deirdre's cuckoo, have a very wide range of species that they will attempt to lay their eggs in the nest of, and some are slightly more specific, like the great spotted cuckoo. So that is one way in which migrants really do have a very negative effect on the local birds, because of course if you're raising somebody else's chick, your offspring are not getting the same amount of attention. It's essentially the cuckoo babies are on benefits. So that's really the only two things I can think of: competition for resources and the parasitism situation. I can't think of any other way. They don't really compete for nest sites because most birds have their own unique nests. They're not too concerned about stealing the nest of others. Maybe in the case of a hole in the tree, but then there's not that many migratory species that are going to target, let's say, for example, a crested barbet's old nest. So there's not a huge effect. And of course, with on the flip side of the competition for resources, is actually more available. Because in summer, in our wet season, it's when we have the rain, it's why the birds come back here. It's because there's an increased insect load. And of course, one of the biggest, in fact, the biggest raptor migration in the world has just completed its sort of the first stage, or the second, depending on how you look at it, the first stage of its journey, and that's in the form of the Amur falcons that have returned to us once again. And that is the largest migration of any predatory bird species. They fly, flock in their millions, stopping off in India, stopping off in Central Africa, and really targeting the termite explosions, population explosions. Those are the only major effects that I can think of with migratory species. But a good, very good question. Lovely question from Nadine on the subject of cuckoos and brood parasitism, because it is one of the most fascinating things out here. And Nadine, you wanted to know if cuckoo babies learn the vocalization of their host species, and how do they then grow up and reach adulthood and learn the vocalization of their own species? And it's a really, very, really very good answer for nature versus nurture, because cuckoos, baby cuckoos, do not imitate their host species in any way. They do not look like them. They do not sound like them. It is this amazing thing that the hosts are so imprinted on a baby that is not theirs that they will still feed it, even though it looks and sounds completely, completely different. And then cuckoos somehow instinctively know the call that they are meant to make when they're adults, the proper call of a fully grown cuckoo. But that's a lovely question, because there are so many intricacies involved with brood parasitism and the way in which it works with the different species. Deirdre's cuckoos, for example, are very good at imitating the egg of the host. But there's a lot of evidence now to suggest that the host species aren't fooled. It's not that they don't realize that they are raising an imposter. And there's even evidence to suggest in certain species of cuckoo that if the host parasite doesn't raise that chick as their own, there's something known as mafia behavior or mob behavior, where the cuckoos will actually, if the host doesn't accept their chicks, they'll go and kick out the host's eggs. They'll go and damage the host eggs. So there's something hugely sinister. Well, maybe, no, that's not really, I suppose that's not a good description, because it's nature. It's not done in the same, with the same knowing awareness that human beings do horrible things. But there is something a little bit sinister about this whole idea, and the fact that a lot of species of cuckoo, the chick will keep, actually not so much cuckoos, honey guides, which are also brood parasites, that will keep their egg tooth for much longer than a normal chick. With a normal chick, that egg tooth is gone shortly after it hatches. But with honey guard chicks, they actually keep that, and they can kill the host's own babies. It is a sinister thing, and it is a very strange, a very peculiar sight when you see a cuckoo, when you see a tiny bird like a waxbill or something, feeding this enormous, clearly grossly disproportionate chick. Right, these are the only mammals we're destined to see this morning, Brian. Hello. Hello, madam. How's the weather? I'll stick to two subjects this morning, the weather and our health. How's the weather there? You enjoying it, girl? Nice and shivery. And unlike our bird species with their preen oil, most of our mammals do not have anything of the sort, and they just get waterlogged and damp. They might have a light oil coating, but for the most part they just get a bit soggy and have to, like we get goosebumps, raise up contract the muscles around the hair follicles to raise up that layer of hair and help to insulate them. Okay, playing hard to get. That's okay, I understand. We are going to continue on in search of all of the things that come out after the rain. It seems as though Brent has found you a scaly one.
Well, here we go. We've got a Speke's hinged tortoise drinking. Now, it almost looks like he's died with his head in a puddle, but you can just see his head moving every now and then and a big swallow of water going down. But really, I didn't know he could hold his breath for this long. Boom. Very slow, big gulps. I just didn't wait to see if he lifts his head up. You can just see those. Boom. There we go. He's trying to drain the puddle. It's been a long dry season. Catching up on his water stores. Sure, I don't know how you can hold his breath for a long time. There we go. Oh, oh, now he's just spotted us. He's like, oh, where did they come from? So, of course, this is wonderful weather for a tortoise. Being slow moving, it takes a while to get between different water sources, and when it is raining, the tortoises are out. Oh, that was quite an impressive length of time he spent with his head under the water. Still not sure about us, because when he put his head down, we weren't here. Okay, off he goes. Now you can see the little hinge on the back where he gets his name from, so he can tuck his back legs in and close the hinge. Hello, Tony. Tony is wondering, what is the shell made of? Well, the inner part of the shell is made of bone. The outer edge of the shell is made of keratin. Now, keratin is the same substance that your fingernails or animals' horns are made of, hair. So basically it's a matted hair. Well, here we go, he's off. He's had his drink, he's now off to go find something to eat. And we're still in search of that male lion. So the last tracks were just up ahead here. I didn't see any coming this way, but it is near impossible to see tracks in this weather. So I just thought we'd have a quick dabble down here. And I sort of wonder if he's tracking the rest of the pride by sound. They weren't far from this area last night. Those tracks were fresh enough to see that they hadn't been rained on too much, so last hour or so. So I was sort of expecting him to be very close. But of course, male lions, if they want to, can walk massive distances, and all he has to do is go over one particularly hard patch of ground, and we're going to miss the tracks. So we're going so slowly. I'm hoping that if we find him, we find the rest of the Nkuhumas. Up ahead on the dead tree. Oh, sorry. I think the roof's in the way. I don't know whether forward or back's gonna be best. Back. I think forward. Oh, there we go. It's flown away, so we go across to Jimmy and see what she's up.
Good timing, because earlier on I tried to stop for a land snail and I didn't have any success because we lost signal. However, there you go, a gastropod for all of you. A giant land snail. They are an impressively sized snail. A lot of them reach the size of our sort of closed fists. Look at him go. My goodness, he's racing along this morning. It's all go, go, go when you're a giant land snail. And this is a very typical species for us to see after the rain or during the rain. Obviously, they are incredibly sensitive to desiccation. They lose water very, very easily. Goodness, it's noisy this morning. It's quite lovely, isn't it? Frogs, birds. The giant land snail isn't contributing to the sounds of the morning. He's just nice to look at. High action. Look at it go. Let me reposition so that you can at least see the head of this particular snail. I know you're all thrilled to see the back of its shell, but let's just try and... hold on. We can do this. We can do this, Brian. We just have to... Hello, stick. Okay. This might seem like a lot of effort for a giant land snail, but we'll get there. Luckily, it didn't disappear while we were turning around. And there we go, a very large giant land snail, leaving behind it just the subtlest of trails. What did somebody call those? Oh! Morning, Mr. Land Snail. Morning, Mr. Ant. What did somebody call the eyes again? The eye stalks. Can't remember who it was. Somebody yesterday in camp called it eye sticks. Eye sticks, that's what it was. It was a Jamie in Final Control, who is here with Desmond. And she called them eye sticks, which I think is the perfect description, because that's exactly what they are. Protruding eye sticks. Our mollusk is galloping along at the rate of knots. These are... We saw yesterday on the bushwalk, we actually saw where the land snails hide on dry days or during dry times. So much like the tortoises we've been seeing, you saw speaks with Brent, they are capable of estivation, which is essentially the dry equivalent of hibernation. Hibernation for cold, aestivation for no rain. And as I said, they're very prone to drying out, which means that when it doesn't rain, they have to go underneath a log or find shelter somewhere, and they actually form a mucus capsule over the entrance to their shell so that they don't lose moisture whilst they're sleeping or whilst their metabolism is slowing down. And then, of course, when rain comes, well, you've got to take full advantage of these moments because you never know when they might come back again. And so it's time to head out in search of something to eat and, of course, a potential mate. And male and land snails carry the reproductive process or parts for both males and females. In other words, they can essentially produce the equivalent of semen and eggs in one individual, which makes sense. If you're only going to have one chance to mate, possibly in your entire life, you might as well try and do it both ways to make the most of that opportunity. Now, earlier on, I said that the morning was beautifully noisy with birds singing and birds croaking. Well, I suppose in the case of the lilac-breasted roller, and frogs croaking. Zombie Kyle, welcome to the sunrise safari on this chilly, rainy morning. You want to know if they make any... Oh, zombie cow. Not zombie Kyle at all. Zombie cow. Apologies, zombie cow. That's a terrifying thought. Zombie cow? No, they are not capable of producing any sound apart from the gentle sloughing of their skin against the rocks and the stones. What sort of sound do you think a snail would make if it could make a sound, Brian?
Hissing noise.
A hissing noise? You think they would hiss?
Yeah, I think they'd hiss.
I think you're probably spot on. Although I'd quite like the idea of them sort of going gloop. I mean, this is definitely not a creature that's going to be singing Pavarotti on a good day. But perhaps a hiss is the best. A hissing snail sounds terrifying. Imagine if that thing was racing down towards you at the rate that it's going now, hissing. I'd run a mile. They are really fascinating to look at, though. It's amazing watching the way it navigates and the eye sticks. The eye sticks are touching the ground and then retreating immediately. And Kathy, you want to know if the shell will grow with them? Oh, this is so fascinating to watch. Whether the shell will grow with them or if they abandon their shells and take up residence in a new one, kind of like a hermit crab. No, they grow with them. So that shell is being made by deposits produced by the snail itself. When they're little, they have a little shell, and you can actually see that because you can see that the bits closest to the snail, the biggest part of the snail shell, that is a beautiful, fresh, reddish-brown color, and you can see the ridges where it's gone through growth spurts, and then as it gets towards the end of the shell, it's been bleached by the sun, and it's aged, and it's lost its pigment. So that is the original part of the snail shell, and it's just continued to lay it down in what's that spiral called? Oh goodness, the
Fibonacci spiral.
That is what I was thinking of. Thank you. That beautiful pattern that nature seems to repeat over and over. I'm going to just turn down the discussion about whether or not it's raining. It is. It is raining. I'm pretty sure we could avoid discussing it. There we go. Now, Raccoon, as our snail races off to in search of breakfast, you want to know what it is they eat. A lot of snails are herbivorous. This particular snail has an interesting aspect to its diet in that they can be carrion eaters. Whilst they have quite a resilient digestive system, as far as I know, they do particularly enjoy congregating and feeding off carcasses. This is interesting. I wonder if it's going to... eat any of these leaves, these wings from the termites. I doubt it. and there can't be much in the way of nutrition in there, but perhaps looking for a termite to consume. Because it would eat any of the dead termites that it might find around here. Scuffling along. It barely looks as though it's moving, and yet it's covering ground. Very powerful muscle contractions along the belly. But yes, they go off in search of carcasses and other such rotting material. They can and do eat carrion. And Graham, you've asked a question that, to be 100% honest with you, I don't fully know the answer to how they grow their shells. Presumably in the same way in which we grow our fingernails. So your body essentially starts to lay down a material or a substance known as keratin that is a particularly hard, and you can think of a snail shell in the same way that we grow fingernails and toenails, and it'll have a growth point underneath the shell, and it'll lay it down, and you can actually see that it's obviously produced in rings, and that those rings run, I suppose you could call it, horizontally along the shell rather than vertically. But beyond that, I don't know the full biology of how a snail grows its shell. And that's a really lovely question, because it's going to send me back to the books after we're finished with the Sunrise Safari to actually try and figure out exactly how that whole process works. I would ask all of you, because of course you are all so good at providing me with those sorts of answers, but I feel as though it might be something that might need a diagram as well. I think it would be, I sort of need to understand where the growth point sits and how it works. There goes the tail. And of course, the slime, which snails are so famous for, collected a whole load of rocks and things underneath its body. It's quite beautiful in a weird way. It's peaceful. Almost mesmerizing. Look at you go! It's amazing watching the way in which it's perceiving its world. You have to wonder about how on earth a snail like this finds a mate, first of all, and second of all, manages to find food, or indeed actually finds anything. This incredibly, not tedious process, but unbelievably slow process. All right. And while we've been watching the mesmerizing motion of our giant land snail, it seems as though perhaps watching this particular scene has sent James right to sleep.
I was totally mesmerized to the point of anesthetized by that snail. Wasn't it a marvelous sighting? It really was very special to see that thing moving so very slowly across the land. Good. All right, we're awake now, and we have a number of interesting things to show you over here. Now, I did say I was going to research something for you when you were last here. I then immediately forgot what it was, and so if you would like to tell me what it was I said I was going to research, that would be wonderful. Now, let's have... Oh, gosh, I'm really making hash of this. You see, I've been so anesthetized by that snail. Now, this is a beautiful copper-colored jewel beetle. Oh! Look at that. Isn't that beautiful? And this was, it's quite alive, it's absolutely living, and it was sitting on a cumbritum bush. Yes, that's, no, it wasn't, it was a wisteria bush. Now what I want to do, I'm just going to try and flip him over slightly and see if I can't make him wake up a little, because he was sitting here cleaning his antenna. What I'm going to do is just warm him up in my hand. I don't think he's conned by that, even vaguely. There we go. Well, there's his underside. There's the underside of him. And he's quite alive. He's just gone sort of dormant for the course of the morning now. He was cleaning his little antenna very carefully. And there you can see his little silver hairs. Anyway, he's going to go back onto his wisteria bushes now. I think you'll find that they're probably extremely specific about which plants they like to live on. So that's the jewel beetle. Then, we were chatting a lot about aposematic coloration, and I managed to find a hopper, which is basically an immature version of a grasshopper here, appropriately underneath the frog book here. Now, this hopper is from the elegant grasshopper, and it is not called a hopper for nothing. It's not called a hopper because it is a flyer or because it is a walker. It is called a hopper because it hops with great skill and speed. And I will now try and catch them. Come here. Come here, hopper. There we are. Got him now. Just hold his legs still. There he is. He's quite impressive, but he's going to look even more impressive when I put him in the microscope. Isn't that cool? So this is an immature of the elegant grasshopper. Now, the elegant grasshopper we know he looks so irritated, so incredulous at having been subjected to what he's been subjected to today. Anyway, that yellow, black, and white is that aposematic coloration, and we know that these elegant grasshoppers or pergamorphid grasshoppers are toxic. And so animals will avoid trying to eat them. The adult version is probably about 2.5 inches tall, long. Sorry, not tall. And this fellow, of course, quite a lot shorter than that. Yeah, he's too is cleaning his antenna now. I just think this is rather special. Don't you? He's and what I want to try and do now, let me just try and move him around a bit slightly. I'm going to try and get you a look at his mouth parts. Ooh. There we go. Isn't that wonderful? You can just see his mouth parts. There we go. And you can see how easy they are to use, these mouth parts, when designing aliens for films. It's exactly what they look like. Little tentacles that are going to suck bits and pieces into his mouth. And his mouth, of course, is totally harmless to us. He is an eater purely of plants. And I think they eat senna quite a lot, which is got all sorts of... Well, it's got different chemicals in them that I think probably this pergamorphid grasshopper is able to manufacture into toxins. And I think also they sit on mbezana, or the bushman's grape, or ivy grape, Cissus cornifolia. But every time I come into this tent, you know, I find that there are thousands of things I want to know about these animals and that I don't really know. That's just too special. Let's quickly focus in on his eyes, and then we'll let him go. Yes, Starwish 246, what a very good comment you make. You say his face looks like an African tribal mask. It does. I'd quite like to make a mask there. Hang on a second. Kirsten, please inform Brent that there is a lion calling, it sounds like, at the Juma Dam. So whoever's closest, either the Juma Dam or on Gowrie Cutline, we can hear a lion going, all right, Brent is now driving at approximately 786 kilometers per hour. Now, there were things under all of these. There are more calling now. Okay, Hopper, off you go. Now, we have another grasshopper. Now, this one is not... This one apparently is even more competent hopper than the rest. But he is not... He does not have aposematic coloration. He's got flash coloration. Now, flash coloration is something slightly different. Now, I cannot let this guy go, because if I let him go, he will disappear in seconds. He's got very powerful legs. He's got legs totally unlike mine. You see that, David? They're very powerful. There we are. Now, that is so cool. Not my nail, of course. I did try and clean it up for everybody, but still, I didn't do a great job. Okay, now let's try the microscope again, and let's see if we can't see. The flash coloration is what happens when you look on the inside of his... when you look on the inside of his legs, there we go, there. Awesome. Now, you can see that black and red color there? What he does is, as he takes off, he's completely hidden. You can see he's beautifully camouflaged. But as he takes off, that black and red color flashes and gives whatever predator has discovered him a fright, and then he folds those legs up again and disappears as he lands on the ground. So although it's the same color as the aposematic coloration, it isn't aposematic. It's not a warning of that he's toxic at all. All it is a sort of flash to give the predators a fright, to disorientate them slightly, and then he disappears into the grass. Okay, so that this fellow, and I'll show you his name. I've forgotten his name, but we found him in the book. Be free. Very nice. Where's the insect book? Sorry, Copper, you're wanting to know about... Do what? The grasshoppers produce what? Oh, do they spit brown stuff so it looks like they're chewing tobacco? I haven't seen any. The hopper, the pergamorphid hopper, I'm afraid, did make... how do we say this politely? It defecated slightly on my hand earlier. Looked a little bit like caterpillar frass, which is a polite way of saying caterpillar dung. But no, it didn't spit any brown stuff. You know what the most common or the most typical example of that I can think of is a millipede. A millipede makes a kind of disgusting, stinking thing that looks like chewing tobacco that's been spat out. Now, there is this thing, that hopper, the grasshopper that we were looking at, and he has no common name. Believe it or not, his name is Tmetonata. Tmetonata. It's quite a nice name. If I ever have a son, I shall call him Tmetonata. Tmetsis. I won't really. That would be ridiculous. Tmetonata, that's him. Right, while Brent keeps racing, we'll keep showing you bits and pieces and trying to relate them to each other desperately. Ah, yes, now, as I... let me just prepare myself for this next bit. As I consider... Polyrhynchus, the ant who's underneath one of these things. In fact, we're going to have a look at an antelope right now. While I tell you that, of course, 'tis the season to be jolly, 'tis the season to be giving. And in order... This lion is coming closer to us. Anyway, there's some impala over there, and there's a nyala in amongst them. And what I'm talking about regarding to the season for giving, of course, if you go to the website shop.wildearth.tv, you will be able to buy a number of branded items for Wild Earth. A t-shirt, a hoodie, in case you wish to rob something, perhaps. A mug, in case you don't have a mug and you wish to drink coffee from something that has Wild Earth branding on it. And indeed, something known as a tote bag, which until yesterday I didn't know existed. It is in fact some sort of shopping bag, but obviously the most elegant kind if it is branded Wild Earth. The important thing to realize about this, of course, is that these ventures, the purchase of these items, will help fund our adventures and therefore your adventures up into Zambia perhaps next year, Kenya perhaps, Rwanda, various other adventures we're hoping to have. So if you know a homeless person, your family and friends, people you don't really like very much, buy them all of these things, your loved ones, your enemies, homeless people. They will all like a tote bag, a hoodie, a mug, and a t-shirt. Buy one for yourself as well. You deserve it. You do deserve it. Joanne, you've bought a tote bag. Isn't it the best bag you've ever had in your life? I bet it is. Good. There are the impala. They're coming closer to us. The rain is also still falling, now slanty-wise, like a thick scotch mist. This is going to be excellent, excellent rain for us. Right, let's move back into the tent because it's getting a little inclement out here, David, and you know we don't like to get wet. Brent and Jamie seem to like it very much indeed, so they can be wet. And I just want to, may I do Polly Rinkers? Now we talk about my favourite friend Polly Rinkers many times, often, find them on walk quite a lot. And this one, I'm hoping, is going to sit still enough for you to be able... No, you see, they just never sit still. They've got these incredible spines on their abdomens. No, it's just not going to sit still. Sit. Be calm, little ant. Be calm. No, it's going to escape. It's now in the microscope. Okay, well, there is Polly Rinkers, the ant. There we go. You can see the spines now on the abdomen, between the abdomen and the thorax. And this is the one, of course, that smells just like a lemon drop. All right, we're going to go fosking about, seeing what else we can find to show you next time you come across the tent. Jamie Patterson has an update for you, and Brent is racing, hopefully, towards where those males were calling.
We do indeed have an update, and the update is it is very, very damp out here, which is wonderful. I can't believe that as a child I ever used to resent rain days, because I never imagined that I would be so happy to see such a settling, driving rain. It looks positively ghostly out there as we look across to the west. Now, unfortunately, what that means is that Brian and myself will be heading for the hills. Well, no, not the hills. That's a slight exaggeration. I don't think I'd call the DRC the hill. We will be heading back to camp and heading back to James's tent, because unfortunately it seems as though our vehicle is about to stop working, and that could actually happen at any second. In fact, I could disappear off your screens at any moment. We're not entirely sure when. So we're going to start heading for home. I will go and join James in the tent where it's nice and warm and sheltered, and where I'm not being dripped upon by this roof. But we've had a wonderful morning, haven't we, Brian?
We have indeed.
Brian is in his, essentially a bug net at the back there. He said he's either swallowed a crumb or a termite. We're not 100% sure exactly what that is or what it was. But we are going to be heading for home. We're very glad that it is raining. It is... Stop dripping on me! Go away! We're very glad that it is raining. Oh, that went down my sleeve. That serves me right. But it does mean that, as intrepid as the Safari Live team is, every now and again one has to call its quits. Now, Brent is able to stay out. He is heading towards those lines. Let's go over to him and get an update.
Now, from what those lines we just heard, all three of us, Jamie, James, myself, all heard them, or it sounded like one male to me. Last place I had tracks was just off to the east of us over there. So I think he's been coming through the block from Hyena Road, and he's around this area somewhere very close. Now, what we're really hoping is for another roar. He might not be quite through here yet. Now, we have checked this road already, but as I said, he's probably moving. The rain's got a little bit harder, but fortunately it's coming from the south of us, so it's coming from behind us. But driving into it earlier was quite uncomfortable. Now, I want to make sure I don't miss anything, and I can't really check behind me. So what we're going to do, it's park like this, where I've got a long, oh, what's that? It is nux, nothing, nada, zip, zilch. Come on, one more raw big boy. Put those back in the case. So I'm pretty sure he's somewhere around here. Let's maybe just move a little bit further to the north. See if he's not just around the last bend of Gowrie Cutline. Now, the nice thing about him calling so close is James is in the tent. So as soon as he roars, James can let FC know, can let me know, so we can switch off if we're moving. And that's going to be our best way of finding him this morning. I think we did well managing to follow tracks for over a kilometer and a half. And there were fresh tracks. You could see that the rain hadn't completely obliterated them yet. So we knew he was close. So close, he's walked on top of my blimming car tracks. Oh, we were here 5 or 10 minutes ago. So that little squiggle in the sand, there, that is a lion track on top of my track. So he's behind me somewhere. Sneaky male lion. Okay, is this how it is this morning, Mr. Birmingham? So he's got to be very, very close. There we go. Oh, and you can see we're going straight south into the rain now. But this lion will not get the better of us. There, track still. Wow. Stop it, rain now. Enough, you can rain once I've found the lion and I'm not moving. So you could have taken a shortcut through here. Now, James Dungan is wondering, when it rains like this, are there restrictions on what roads you can drive on? Are certain roads out of bounds? It hasn't quite rained enough yet, but I'd say if this rain carries on through the day, yes, certain roads along seep lines, they'll definitely be closed. Now, just trying to see if I can see a track here. I mean, we must have missed him by mere minutes. He could still be on the move. Whoa, there we go. Thought I heard something. Okay, while we continue to get wet, let's go have a look at that very dry, probably quite smug James Hendry in the tent.
Did he just describe me as smelly? I really think that that is some pot and kettle stuff going on there. Anyway, let's... I did find something else for you. I found a termite that had met a very sad end. Now, of course, I talk very elaborately and animatedly about the celebration, of course, that is, oh, sorry, smugly, not smelly. Very animatedly about the taking off of the alates and the celebration that is the termite emergence. Unfortunately, not all termites are able to celebrate. Some of them have accidents. And this termite, despite being largely the sort of food for so many animals, I found impaled. It impaled itself on a thorn. And now it is dying. But its imminent demise is an advantage to us because now we can have a proper look at it under the microscope. Here we go. This is called termite safaris, everybody. Normally, we like to search for big cats. Well, not anymore. Those days are over. We are now a termite safari operation, which I think is much easier. There we go. Now, I am not in any way restraining this fellow. I'm afraid he's just kind of in the last throes of his life. And you can see still going through the natural instinct of the insects, and that is, of course, to clean one's antenna with great care, because if you don't have antenna, you can't tell where you're going or who you're trying to find. And it's those antenna, I think, that will pick up on the pheromones of a potential mate. In this one's case, unfortunately, I don't think it's ever going to have a mate, David.
No.
I think it's going to die fairly soon. Anyway, we will release it. As with all the animals out here, we don't know if they're going to survive or not. But there you can see it filled with nutritious fat. And let's just have a look at the abdomen there. I'll just try and refocus. There we go. Now, although that is filled with the intestines and things, it really is a highly, highly nutritious thing. Now, Michael, you're wondering what the lifespan of a termite is, and it very much depends on the termite, Michael. If it is an alate like this one, it could potentially be a king or a queen and therefore live in excess of a decade, believe it or not, especially if it's a queen. So that's quite impressive. I don't think the workers last anything like that long. I think you'll find the workers and soldiers probably don't last much longer than a season. Many of them will die fairly soon after a sort of year or so. Most of them, of course, will be eaten. But the potential lifespan of one of these alates is up to 10 or 15 years, which I think is tremendously impressive. Right, so that's that one. Then Steph came wandering by earlier on, and of course when Steph comes wandering by the tent, it's a great honour because he does find a whole lot of things. And he told me two very interesting things. The first, I told him about the Bushveld rain frog that we found. He said, yes, that's the male. And the male is much smaller than the female, and certainly that one was much smaller than the female that Brent found earlier this morning. Remember, he referred to it as a her. And apparently, what she does is she kind of wears the male as a sort of sperm-filled satchel. She puts him on her back, and she's got some kind of adhesive, and she wanders around with him. And when the desire to lay eggs takes her, then she lays the eggs and he fertilizes them. And he's only about that big, and she's about that big. Isn't that cool? Right. Then he also found this millipede shell, which we see many, normally on bushwalk, normally either in civetry or outside at a scorpion burrow. But look at the articulation of it. It's not broken yet. And so it still articulates. And you can see there how, when the millipede is moving, its body articulates against itself. So those are the different scales articulating against each other, which I just think is rather impressive. Also, we can see the legs, and what we'll do is have a look at the legs with the microscope. It's starting to rain again quite heavily, and unfortunately, those lions haven't called again. I don't know that they weren't... Yeah, maybe Brent should check quarantine clearings as well. I don't know that they weren't heading this way. I don't know where Brent is at the moment, But he might want to, if he's failing where he is now, to just check quarantine clearings. Ooh, look at that. Look at the claws. Oh, a millipede looks like an innocuous animal, everybody, but if you happen to be microscopic yourself, oh, watch out. Hundreds of claws on the millipede. Each segment has got four legs. No, each segment has one pair of legs. Many, 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 many different. No, they don't. That's rubbish. I've read that before, but it's clearly untrue. Let's focus in there. Each segment has got two pairs of legs. That's interesting. So each segment of a millipede has got four legs on it, and they've got nasty claws on them. So you'd have to watch out if you were something very small that wanted to eat a millipede. Right, there we are then. Okay, now, I think it's time probably to move away from the microscopic and go slightly to the macroscopic, mainly because I'm now unable to go outside to fetch you more microscopic things because it is raining. Now, behold this great shelf of death. Safari Dean, I'm afraid I've missed your question about frogs calling. Let's have it again. Oh, is their call purely for finding mates? Safari Dean, at this time of the year, it is also singing Christmas carols, of course. It is very important to sing Christmas carols at this time of the year to get yourself and the wildlife around you into the spirit. I'm obviously talking complete nonsense. Yes, it is largely for finding mates. I don't think it's territorial in the same way that it is for birds. You know, birds will call territorially as well as to attract mates, but I think this is also, I think with frogs, it's largely to attract mates, yeah. Very good question. I'm just quickly going to look over the back here to make sure that nothing is getting wet because the rain is starting to fall quite heavily. We look to be okay over there. Let us look here at the zebra skull, which feels a little bit wet, which is a little worrying. I think it's all right. Okay, now we think this is a zebra skull. It's certainly the skull of an equid. Of course, the per people we bought it from could easily have sold us or something like that, but we think this is a zebra. Now, one of the big differences between it's used for cropping grasses, as you can see, obviously, but it's also used for defense. These teeth grow continuously, and while a zebra might be thought of as a kicking animal, they are bites as well. And I don't know if you've ever been bitten by a horse or been unlucky enough to be set upon by a horse. It is a terrifying thing, and it is deeply, deeply painful. I've been bitten twice very nastily by a horse, three times not so nastily. And it is extremely painful indeed. And these teeth are sharp, the jaws are immensely powerful, and they're a very effective defensive mechanism. So that's one of the major differences there. Then, if we open it up and look at the grinding teeth there, you can see the dentine and the enamel. The enamel is the sort of really ivory-colored white stuff. The dentine is the slightly less ivory-colored stuff. And you can see these teeth are beautifully, beautifully preserved, and they grow continuously. Now, if you own a horse, you have to file its teeth every so often because, of course, they eat concentrated food quite a lot of the time. A zebra is constantly chewing, and so it's filing its own teeth down all the time. They're quite a rough, they really are rough grinding edges, and you can see how they'd be able to grind their food into the appropriately small size of particle that will help them to digest them. So that's the other interesting thing there. And then the last thing I wanted to tell you about the zebra, and I mean I always relate them to horses because I like horses, is this gap here. Now again, I don't know if you've ever ridden a horse before or had to saddle one up, but I remember when I was a very small boy and I was being taught how to put a bridle on a horse, they said, well, if the horse won't open its mouth, you just put your thumb into its mouth there underneath the top bottom lip and it'll open up. And of course, that's terrifying if you don't know that the horse has no teeth here. But it is a remarkable thing that there's this complete gap between the front teeth and the back teeth start. And so you just slip your hand in there, open it up, slip the bit in, and off you go, David. Mm. Yeah. We go cantering into the distance.
Oh, good.
Yes, it is good. It's a good fun. Not in the rain, though. And if you just will put your camera to the outside briefly, you will see there, everybody, that the rain is really starting to come down again. And right now I am feeling deeply, deeply smug that I'm not out in the wilderness and that Brent Leo Smith is. Mainly because he was offered the option of the walk last night, as I said, and he turned it down on account of his hip, which made a miraculous recovery. I'm missing the name here about a question about wild horses.
Siamin?
Siamamin? Theonmin? Theon Greyjoy? Spell it, Kirsten. Siamin, not Theon Greyjoy. Okay, you want to know about wild horses in Africa and if we have any here. We don't have wild horses, no, but there is a population of feral horses, so that's domestic animals that have gone wild, if you like. And yes, we do have some of those in Namibia. There's a whole herd of them, and if I'm not mistaken, they have a very interesting story that... I'm worried about the rain now, that comes from the First World War. And the German soldiers that were in Namibia at the time, apparently just when they, you know, when they lost the war, not because they lost the war, but they went home, and they left all of their horses there. They just left them there. And that herd of horses, I think this is the origin of it, went feral. And they now wander the desert, and they have done for many, many, many years, and somehow they survive out in the desert on their own with no human intervention whatsoever. So that's the only sort of herd of wild horses that there are in Africa. And of course, the reason for that is that horses don't come from Africa. Horses come, if I'm not mistaken, from Eastern Asia. So far northeastern Asia, I think around the steppes of Mongolia. And it's only there that you still find the last truly wild populations of horses. And those are known as Przewalski's horse. They're small. And not anything like the big breeds that you find in some European stables and certainly some American stables as well. And I think those are the original horses that the rest of the horses of the world were seeded from. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, the horses of the Americas were probably brought there by the Spanish. I think that's probably how they got there. And certainly I think you probably find herds of feral horses in the Americas as well. So that's a little origin of the horses. Now, let's have a look at these skulls. Brent is still trying desperately to find the lions. He's also trying to stay dry and keep the equipment dry. So if you are wondering what he's doing, he is still trying desperately to find a cat. Okay, this is a baboon skull. And I really desperately want to get a human skull in this. I know that sounds macabre, but I mean, of course, once a human's gone, they are gone. Or maybe a model of a human skull, because to compare it with the monkey skull and our skull and the baboon skull. Let me try and do the same angle. Yes? Can you see it looks quite similar? I think would be rather fascinating. And of course, what you'll find in most human cases, probably not mine, is that the brain case for the humans is obviously that much more enormous than it is for any of the others. But proportionately, I think the monkey's brain case is much larger. The baboon, possibly not great at calculus. The monkey, slightly better at it. And of course, the human being, excellent at calculus. And that's probably got largely to do with social makeup. And there's certainly, you can predict an animal's social makeup from the size of its brain. And of course, the other interesting one that we think that our human brain got so very large. This is a very bad place to put these. There we go. We think one of the reasons that the human brain got so large was because of our complex social behavior, and that our human ancestors were knocking about the plains of East Africa, more sort of socially involved with each other. And if you go closer towards human being along the primate line, so we go from the baboon to the monkey and then perhaps into the great apes like the chimpanzee, as the brain gets bigger, so and of course, you get to the human being and our ability to psychologize each other, to kind of read each other's and try and read each other's emotion and intentions is highly, highly sophisticated, far more than any other animal. And we think, quite apart from the sort of tool making and the need to hunt and live and hunt cooperatively that drove the size of our brains, is probably actually much more the need to manipulate of our very vast brain. And I just think that that's rather fascinating. And in fact, on that note, if you ever want to read more about that particular subject and our origins, I might just do a little advertisement here for old John Reader and his quite phenomenal book, Africa, The Biography of a Continent. You will find just about anything that you ever wanted to know about this continent in this quite remarkable book, which you can by myself over the years. Right, Brent Leo Smith is out in the rain. Let's get an update on his lion tracking.
Well, we actually haven't moved in about 8 minutes. The rain got too hard, so we parked our bottom towards the west, where the rain is coming from. We don't often get rain from the west, but when it does come, it certainly sets in. So unfortunately, some wet, so we've just parked facing away. We were hoping that it was going to abate, but it actually just seems to get stronger and stronger. Now, that last lion track was probably 100 meters up the road. I'm quite sure he's doing the exact same thing as we are, putting his bum to where the weather's coming from and just snuggling. So I think we're gonna try now make our way back towards camp. We're not too far, and maybe go join James and Jamie. Now, we could fold up and, because we can actually close this whole contraption, but I can't see seeing any tracks. The rat tracks have now definitely been obliterated by the rain, and I don't think we're going to be able to find this male in this weather. Hopefully he'll pop out for the sunset safari though. But we must remember how wonderful this is, even though it does make the safari a little bit difficult. We do need the rain, and this is a good soaking rain. It's not something that's just a fleeting rain. It's been raining almost constantly since just before 4 a.m. So a really good couple of hours of rain. And if the clouds stay over, that rain will soak into the ground rather than being evaporated by our burning sun. At least we got to see a bushveld rain frog this morning. One of my favorite frog species. I'm not sure about the toad you saw with James, which one it is, but I'm just trying to see. Wow, there's no gap in it at all. Oh, apparently James also had a bushveld rain frog this morning. Okay, you can see there's alates around. Well, Kyle in Michigan, do we have any form of thing that I can dry my hands with back there? Probably not, yeah. Oh, it's even soaked through to my shirt, but I'll use my shirt. Oh, yeah. You can see my starting to become very wrinkly. Maybe there's something in here I can dry my hands with. Kyle, I think, oh dear, everything is wet. Let's see if I can make this work in the wet. Oh no. There we go. That should work. Maybe I can get it to work. It'll be one of the ghost frogs, Kyle. I'm trying to remember which ghost frog. I think it could be one of the Western Cape ghost frogs. So they are, there we go. Frogs. And ghost frogs. This should be up. Reed frogs. Cape ghost frog, I'm just trying to remember which is the rarest of them. Table Mountain ghost frog, I think it could be. So there we go. Oh, I don't know. So it only occurs on Table Mountain, so you can barely even see that there's any sign of a distribution map. I'll show you a picture of him now. There you go, the Table Mountain ghost frog. So a very endemic frog species. Most of your ghost frogs are very, very endemic to very specific parts of the world. And that's probably the rarest frog in South Africa, only occurring in a few streams that flow off Table Mountain. Okay, we're going to brave it. Thank you for the cloth. And put my cellular device back into the pelican case where it's nice and dry and toasty like James in the tent. So let's go see out.
No, we don't have coffee, anybody. We have got no coffee whatsoever, but we do have a rather bedraggled figure here. But of course, when you are inescapably in at all times, even the bedraggled nature of your being can be entertaining. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Jamie Patterson.
Hi. We made it. We're alive. I'm really damp. I'm quite cold, and my hands look like something that... Oh, that's gross. That is horrible.
Yes. Well, like I was saying, very elegant indeed.
Lovely. Charming. Hello.
Now, I'm going to give this to you.
You're going to give that to me?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
And I'm going to hold one too.
All right.
And what we are going to do, yes, Jamie's audio is soft because she's not plugged in.
All right, I will shout across to James's hat.
There we are. Is that better, Kirsten?
Hello. Sorry.
Oh, God. Now, what we will do, everybody, is have a look at these skulls and things. I'm afraid going outside and finding artifacts in the rain is now not a problem. A possibility. Now,
I don't know, I can go.
Elina, you're wondering about brain size. So let's have a discussion about general brain size here. Now, you will see that there are two brain sizes there, and the carnivores there, and then we have the primates here. Elina, you're wondering which animal has the biggest brain size. I'm going to put them proportionately in order as they go in the tent here now from the primates. This is how they go. They go baboon, vervet monkey, James Hendry, Jamie Patterson. That is the size, that's the biggest brain in proportionately is the one over there on the far left-hand side there.
The other way around.
No, not the other way around at all. The human being, Elina, has a brain size of about 1,200 cubic centimeters, if I'm not mistaken. That is about 1.2 liters. And in gallons, no, not gallons, it's in pints, that's just under 3 pints of brain matter that you, me, well, Jamie's got about 4 pints, but the rest of us have about 3 pints of brain.
That's now, the weirdest compliment I've ever
yes,
received.
Well done.
James has got about four pints of brain.
Interestingly, we are not the biggest brained animal ever to have lived, proportionately. That honour, and I find this really fascinating, it's become something of an obsession for me lately, that honour is to the Neanderthal. Which is amazing. We outbred or killed or ate, or we don't really know, the Neanderthal human beings. Their brain case was almost 4 pints. It was 1,600 cubic centimeters, 1.6 liters of brain in the Neanderthal skull. And I think that's quite something, because we tend to think of ourselves as being the cleverest species. And certainly on Earth now, we have the, well, I mean, by way of abstract thought, we seem to be the most clever species on the planet. But it's quite possible that Neanderthals, who we think buried their dead, could have even had some kind of art, may well have had a religion at the time. They could possibly have had a more sophisticated language than us. We don't know.
Can you imagine how different things would have been?
Yeah.
If it had worked the other way around, if whatever circumstance happened that the Neanderthals didn't succeed, if they had,
yeah,
and we died out, well, you know.
Yes, quite.
Yes.
You'd be looking at somebody with a much higher brow ridge right now.
And a very flat nose.
And a flatter nose, mm-hmm. Yes. And apparently, there are a lot of people around the world, about, I think Northern Europe contain 6% DNA that is from Neanderthals. So, next time, if you happen to be a Scandinavian and you throw out the insult to somebody that they're behaving like... Now, let's move on to the carnivore skulls and their brain sizes. What we have there are two animals, obviously. Jamie, you know what they are, do you?
I do.
Oh, good.
We've got our wild dog and our leopard.
Our wild dog and our leopard. Sorry, Jamie, can't be heard.
Oh, wild dog and leopard.
There we are. There we go. And which one do you think is bigger brained?
I'm actually going with the... It's got a bigger...
It does, and I was surprised about that when I saw it. Because the social arrangement, of course, of a leopard is that much more simple. It's a totally solitary animal. But it's really about purely the size. It's about which region of the brain, I suppose, is bigger. And I'm no brain expert, but the dog looks to have a slightly larger rear end here of the cerebrum. Of the cerebrum, and the leopard's definitely more sunken. Now, I don't know in these carnivores whether the same regions of the brain that do different things like ours do, whether the same regions in a leopard do the same things as the same regions in the brain in us, I don't really know. But perhaps that back part of the brain there on the wild dog gives it some way of being more social. What do you think?
I think that's entirely plausible. I have no idea. I can't comment on...
Right, well, good.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll go with my theory then. That's
anyway.
Excellent. Yeah. Right, Jamie says she's not really sure, which is ideal, because that means that she is not going to contradict me. Phew, that's lucky. Now, let's move on to another brain here. Now, proportionately, that's the leopard you're looking at and a serval. And a serval, for those of you who don't know, is the sort of size of a domestic cat, a big domestic cat with long legs. And
That's
think its brain looks bigger, don't you?
I think it is too.
It also is a totally solitary animal. So I think that's quite interesting. So, Michael, you're saying is brain size related to body size? Absolutely it is. I mean, an elephant's brain is much bigger than a Neanderthal's brain, but proportionately it's not. So an elephant's brain is actually pretty large for the size of the animal that it is, but it's
about
not...
about three times ours, isn't it?
It's about three times the size of ours, but proportionately it's much smaller. So by proportion, I mean per unit of body mass, the brain of a human being or the Neanderthal are vastly bigger than any other animal. So yes, it is proportional. So yes, absolutely the leopard's brain is bigger than the serval's, but proportionately you can see that the brain case of the serval takes up more space.
Now, it's actually almost, it's not that far off the leopard.
It's not that far off, no. So quite similar. And of course they live in very similar sort of social structure. They're both completely solitary. And yeah, you know, if you're a... That's all I have to say on that matter, in fact.
I started watching an evolutionary background on cats, big cats and small cats, and caracals.
Mm-hmm.
They were one of the original species that evolved in Africa.
No.
Apparently.
Really?
That's what, I mean, I didn't go into the full detail of it because it was in passing, but it looked as though what they were saying is Panthera is one of the oldest genuses. And then in terms of the cats spreading from Asia, where they originated, or at least where the common ancestor originated, it looks as though the caracal was one of the first to emerge as a distinct species.
In Africa?
In Africa.
How big is its brain? About that big.
I'm not sure.
Now, somebody with a brain and it's covered in a great mass of now very wet hair is Brent Leo Smith. Let us go and take a look at his bedraggled form.
Bedraggled indeed. I was hoping we might find one bedraggled impala on quarantine and park our bottom into the rain and wait it out for the last bit of drive, but I literally am not seeing one animal. We've come and checked here. Oh, now the rain roof is raining on me, but fortunately presenters are the most waterproof thing on the vehicles, so we get a bit more wet than everything else, which is fine. Come on, not even one animal, one bird. Wait, there's some bedraggled impala. Hello, Tracy. And Tracy would like to know, will the rains bring the chameleons out and cause the eggs to hatch? Ah, I hope so, Tracy. I think they will. The other thing they will do is cause some flowers to hatch. Oh, hatch. Bloom, sorry. No, flowers don't hatch. They don't come from eggs. Okay. Now, you can see how I look, but if we look at an impala in this weather, that's how I feel. Hello, impararas. They don't look very happy. They look cold and miserable. We got cold and miserable impalas in the rain. See what they're doing? They're trying to stand next to these bushes. The rain is coming from the other side of the bush. But impalas, I know from experience, it doesn't work. Maybe just a little, maybe breaks up that cold wind that is coming through. And see all the, oh, I can't see what you, all the alates as well, fluttering in front of them. Oh, shaggy. I think I'm going to go shake my head and with my long hair, wet hair, next to James and Jamie shortly. Come on, give us a little, one more good shake. One more good shake. Get rid of some of that water. Not that water, silly. Well, we must always be thankful for the rain and all the new growth. Nick1011 says, thought animals would be refreshed by the rain. Well, they're refreshed by what the rain brings, the standing water and the grass. But after it rains for a while, even the animals get a bit tired of it. Let me just take off my hood. Now, I did see something that I haven't seen just yet. It seems to have softened up a little bit. Let me see if I can reverse back to what I spotted before I spotted the impala. Now, I'm not sure. I think we have seen one of these flowers already this year. But they haven't been particularly impressive specimens. This one looks to be the most impressive specimen of Anthericum I've seen this year. And it's still relatively short. Okay, now I can't see. Okay, let me go back a little bit more. Okay, that white spot there is a little wildflower called an Anthericum. Very, very pretty. And that's the tallest one I've seen. Sometimes they can almost get as tall as my waist, but this year I haven't seen any big ones. That's the tallest one I've seen this year. But hopefully with the rain, it's going to get a bit better. Now, there's something everyone likes to do in the rain. Now, Janky's wondering, what is the best smelling plant or flower? I would have to say wild jasmine, Janky. That's my favorite. Okay. Now, I'm sure all of you have done this at some point in your life. I'm just trying to find the correct spot to do this. A little bit further, I think. We've got to find yes, there we go. Let me just have a look on the monitor whether you can see that nicely. No, you don't want one that's too deep. Can you see that puddle nicely? Let's have a look. Yes, we can. Okay, now, because it is the first of the sort of, well, not the first rain, but the first decent rain we've been out on drive, I have to do it. because it's raining and the bush is green and wonderful. And there's a puddle. So here we go. Yay for the rain! As cold and wet as it is a wonderful blessing, and hopefully the bush is going to recover from the drought quickly. Now I've got mud in my boot. That wasn't very clever, was it, Leo Smith? But anyway, it was worth it. Okay. Let's see what else is going on. It has softened up a little bit, so we are able to move. We don't have to just sit with our bottoms facing the southwest where the rain was coming from. Now, a lot of animals are going to be trying to keep out of the rain, although it does feel like it's warming up a little bit, and it's softening, the rain's softening a little bit, so that could cause some of the animals to come out, definitely some of the birds to carry on feeding. But while we go see what else we can find, let's go back to the two in the tent.
We're trying to find Brent's anthericum bush here in this blasted flower guide, which I never can find anything in. Anyway, we've done some more brain research, everybody, because that's what brains do, they research. Don't they, Jamie?
They do.
Yes. Tell us what we have here.
Research is a very strong term.
Yes. Tell us.
We pick them up.
Yes.
So we have a very interesting, and this is actually the difference here is far more noticeable than it was with the leopard and the wild dog, in terms of our tinier carnivores. So we have a civet over here, in my left hand, on your right. So this is a civet. Have a look at the size of its brain. I don't mean to insult civets around the world, but
He ain't going to be winning any competitions for IQ, is he?
No. Exactly, yeah. So that's not Einstein.
No.
In contrast, we do have an animal that's famous for being very clever and famous for being a problem solver.
Mm.
Also famous for other things, including being rather bad-tempered and quite aggressive. This is a honey badger skull. And the brain case is absolutely massive in comparison. I mean, they're roughly... Okay, badgers are slight. No, they're actually the same size, basically. A badger's actually smaller.
Probably shorter, but probably heavier.
Yeah.
Stockier.
I'd say it's a close thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So clearly the badger is built for thinking.
And massive problem solving. And I mean, the first time I ever saw that was before I became a guide. In fact, it was at guiding school when I was, and we used to watch VHS videos in the night, if you can believe it, back in the year 2000. Those were the days. And there was a BBC video, I think it was, and the badger found a nest of a mud-dwelling bird up on a bank that it couldn't reach, and it sort of reached up and tried to get its claws in and couldn't do it, turned around, looked about the place, walked off, found a log, rolled the log up to the base of the nest, stood on the log, reached into the nest and ate the kingfisher chicks out of the nest, which I think was just quite astounding to see. Then a little while back, and I think a lot of this was set up, but there was that video from Maholoholo down the road of Stoffel the badger, and I mean that is a dreadful name for anything, especially a badger. But Stoffel was set a number of tasks. So although I think it was kind of presented that he had all of these tasks that he performed were random, he was set a number of tasks in order to escape from his enclosure. And I mean, he did things like he built ladders out of brooms and he put things on top of each other to get out of his predicament. And it really is quite astounding how brilliant the honey badger is. And certainly, I wonder whether any other animal would be able to follow a honey guide without that level of intelligence. Now, James Richard, you're wondering about the size of a domestic cat's brain compared with that of a serval. In my opinion, domestic cats are profoundly gormless creatures. That's very unkind, because I know a lot of you have got cats, and my mother would be very upset with me. I think it's probably about the same size as an African wild cat's brain, yeah. They don't come from servals, of course. They come from African wild cats, all domestic cats, and so probably roughly serval-sized, I guess, proportionately.
Mm. I would say so. Maybe proportionally the same. Yes. Maybe a bit smaller just physically, but maybe, you know, they've also lost a lot of...
That's the thing.
I don't know how quickly that would reflect in your brain mass.
Yeah.
That change in the way in which they live, because they've been domesticated for a long time, and I wonder whether that's had that sort of loss of a necessity to hunt and survive. Although feral cats still do. Mm. So.
I would say it's probably had almost no effect on the brain size. I mean, they've probably been domesticated for 5,000 years or so, which is a blink of evolutionary time. So. No, I wouldn't say that they're necessarily any more dim-witted from a physical point of view. But yes, I mean, I imagine some things might change, some traits that would be essential in a domestic animal, at least in a wild animal, may have been lost in a domestic animal. And certainly, I mean, so if you, I'm trying to think of an example, but an African wildcat will have certain instincts that without which it would certainly die in the wild, whereas a domestic cat will survive and without some of those instincts and pass those genes on. And so they will be very different, but I don't think the size of the brain would necessarily have changed.
It's interesting that we're having this conversation, because last night Jerry Brent and myself had exactly the same conversation about humans in the car park last night. We were just discussing it. We were on our way off to go back to Inga's, go to bed. And we're talking about the fact that I strongly believe that human beings still have residual... We definitely have residual instincts. Mm. But I've definitely been walking. I don't know if it's ever happened to you in the bush, where you've been out walking and something has said to you, stop, look, there's something. And it's not, you're not consciously aware of hearing or smelling or seeing anything. But there's something, it's sort of goosebump stuff. And you suddenly, the hairs on the back of your neck are... And more than once, I've turned around and I've been watched by a buffalo or a very memorable occasion of leopard that as soon as it realized I'd seen it, shot away and disappeared. So I think that we still have residual nerve pathways in our brain. We just don't know how to tap into them anymore.
I think the most obvious example of something like that is the sound of a snake. And I remember the first time I heard a puff adder hiss at me. Never heard it before. I'd never had it explained to me. But when that puff adder hisses, your body goes into a completely automatic reaction. And I was walking along, and it wasn't a puff adder, it was a night adder. And they make a noise. And I was about to put my foot down, and this thing made that hissing sound at me. My body knew exactly what it was straight away. My foot just stopped, and I moved back immediately, and there was the snake. I'd never heard it before. No one had ever explained it to me at all, and so it really was quite amazing to perceive that. Now, Michael, you had a question, and I'm afraid I missed what it was. Kirsten, you're going to have to go again. Oh, right. Okay, Michael, you want to know about the TV shows. Michael, our TV shows are going to begin. Well, we have one on the 15th of this month. I'm not sure what time it is. Kirsten, what time is it? 4 to 6 our time in the afternoon. So you can work out what time that is for you. And then, of course, the most exciting thing, the 8-week series that will take place from the 1st of January Eastern Standard Time, 10 p.m. So that's 2200 hours Eastern Standard Time on Nat Geo Wild for 8 weeks, commencing on Sunday, the 1st of January, 2017. Yes, that's what I said, everybody, all the way into next year, which is now only 3 weeks away.
Which is utterly terrifying.
Isn't that astounding? All right, everybody, that is going to be it from the tent. I would like to congratulate my colleague Jamie for lasting as long as she did out there in the wetness. And just bear a thought for us as Brent comes back, because he will be telling us all about it for a very long time to come. Let's go and say goodbye to him. We'll see you later this afternoon.
Bye-bye.
Well, we've put our backside towards the weather again, and just taking in the last few moments before the end of the sunrise for you. I'm quite disappointed we didn't find that male lion. His tracks were on top of our tracks, but then unfortunately that rain just came in a little bit hard and we couldn't follow them. But I'm sure he's around. I'm quite confident we'll find him on the sunset safari. Now, we are not dry. Well, Desmond is dry. Yes, Desmond's dry. I'm not dry, and... I've even got wrinkly fingers today. So there we go. But it has been wonderful just to be out in the rain. And remember that Klitmos is around the corner, and to help us travel to far exotic locations such as the Chobe waterfront, Liwa Plain in Zambia, the Mara and Rwanda, please visit our online shop. I think it's on the Wild Earth website. You can find it. Well, just have a look on the Facebook page. And oh, there we go. shop.wildearth.tv is the spot to go look. There's shirts, there's vests, there's long shirts, there's cups, there's all sorts. And we would really appreciate your support there. And hopefully that'll lead us into taking you to some new amazing places next year. Very, very exciting. Now, and hopefully we're going to be able to go visit all the places. So Liwa Plains with the second largest wildebeest migration. Chobe waterfront with the thousands upon thousands of elephants that come down to drink. And of course also elephant hunting lions in that area. Also massive crocodiles, hippos, incredible part of the world. And of course we know about the Rwanda and the Mara. Again, definitely places we want to do more stuff in. So remember, shop.wildearth.tv. Now, it's going to be interesting to see. I think this might settle in for quite a while. May or may not be raining on the sunset safari. If it is, we will be out there. I'm going to go take a hairdryer and dry my not-so-rainproof rain suit. but hopefully we'll be able to find that male lion. But if not, there should be some incredible frogs and insects out after the rain, especially if we do get a little bit of sun during the day. Very exciting. Our first proper rain, or soaking rain, should I say. And let's hope it continues till just before the sunset safari and then starts again just after the sunset safari. But from Desmond and myself and the rest of the Safari Live crew, we'll see you in a few short hours for another adventure in the African bush.